What up? What up, podcast party people? How you doing? How you living? Tuning in for a good one today. That's right, motherfuckers. We got a good one today. I'm excited. We got Thrash legend Chuck Billy. Chuck Billy. I don't know why I said it with a French accent. Chuck Billy from Testament up on the podcast. Yeah. It is a good one. It's a heavy one, man. It's funny. We go deep. Some crazy shit. He brings up some stuff that I'd never heard. It was some wild shit. I'm kicking it here. I got Subs Club over here on Twitch watching me do the intro. That's right. Hanging out. They might even be saying things. I can't. They're probably saying something nasty. Something inappropriate. That's for sure. But I tell you what, it's been a crazy week here. But one of the good things, some good news, start off with some good news here. One of the good things is that the fires are finally under control in California. I want to give a huge shout out to all of the essential workers, all of the firefighters, all of the fire stations all over California that have fucking crushed it to put these fires out. There's still a shit ton of smoke. Oh my God, so much smoke in the air still. There's just a thick haze of smoke. But a lot of the burnt particle smell that you get is kind of gone, so it's just like this thick haze. And shout out to all the firefighters, though, man. Shout out to everybody who went up there and helped put it out. Jesus, what a freaking nightmare. We had 600 fires burning at one point. We had this crazy, you know, we found out about it kind of as it came about. Like about a week later, we knew more. But we had a crazy dry thunderstorms, they were calling them. So no rain. We would just get thunder and lightning. And we had, in a 7-day period, we had 13,000 lightning strikes. 13,000 lightning strikes. It's fucking crazy. Like a record we've never had. And it was in the middle of a heat wave and we were having all this shit. Like we were having just record, you know, I mean, insane. 130 degrees in Death Valley. It was nuts. So we finally got through that. We still actually have three major fires burning. My campground, the campground that I go to at Berryessa, both of them burned down to the ground. Berryessa, the place where I go wakeboarding. I'm not even sure if we're allowed to go there right now. But it is literally burned to the ground. The whole lake and everything around it. All the houses, horses. I saw these horrible pictures of like dead horses and dead cows. It was so fucking sad. I saw them and I thought about posting them on Instagram and I'm like, no one needs to see this. This is fucking so sad. But I was just looking at it because it was all the area where we go camping. And so I wanted to see what was still standing, if anything at all. It doesn't look like there's much. So, which is a shame because it's wine country. There's a lot of wine there. A lot of vino. This is like part of, it's technically Napa Valley, but it's kind of almost Sacramento. Like it's kind of out of the Napa area, the fancy Napa area. But they do have a lot of wineries there, like a lot of it's not even wineries. It's like they just it's an area that produces grapes and then they sell it off to the winery, you know, so they sell it to a bunch of different wineries around there. So it's just like a grape farm basically. But yeah, they're all, I can't even imagine that there's anything left of there. It was so much fire and destruction. But we've only got three fires burning right now, and all of them are about 75% contained, which is, you know, great compared to, and it's just crazy because, like, normally this shit starts in September. It starts in October. It doesn't start, fire season does not start in August. Like, that's too early. Yeah, man, just crazy. But they got it under control. It's coming under control. I can't imagine it's not going to be, you know, I think we're going to be in for a rough year. That's for sure. If it's starting this early. But again, shout out to all the firefighters. all the essential workers up there who put their lives on the line and risk, you know, so much just to take care of that stuff. Much appreciated. Much appreciated. What else? What else can I tell you? What else can I tell you here? I got the Twitch twats watching me. What are you saying, Twitch twats? Yeah, I'm streaming. That's right. I'm on Twitch, motherfuckers. Twitch.tv/RobFlynn. If you're interested, if you're on Twitch, come check me out. I qualified for affiliate like fucking 3 weeks ago, filled out all the paper or all the online, you know, shit to fill out. 2 weeks went by, nothing, crickets, like didn't hear shit. Started over. Now I'm back. I've been 3 weeks now just trying to fill out fucking paperwork. I got to say their fucking customer service sucks. It does. Twitch's customer service fucking sucks. I wrote them a few times and I'm like, I wrote them five times now, actually. And the first three times I wrote them, they were like, what you've written down doesn't correspond with the drop down menu that you chose. And I'm like, you know, I've got a payout. You know, all I'm having is a pay. I just want to get past the payout stage, which I'm under review for or whatever. I'm like, you don't have an option for payout. So I'm just putting this in the general area. Your text does not correspond with the drop down. I'm like, you don't have the drop down menu that I need. Probably on purpose, you fucks. Motherfuckers. I do like the vibe, though. It's a good vibe. I've been raided a couple times already. Paolo from Trivium raided me a couple of times. Gene Hoagland raided me yesterday. Herman Lee raided me. So it's a good vibe. I like it. Seems like all the subs club is digging it. Better video, better sound, cooler emojis, all kinds of good stuff. They got mosh emojis. They got circle pit emojis. They got jump emojis. I'm digging it. Digging it. We were over on Facebook for a minute there doing the subscriber thing, but man, that was a fucking clusterfuck. They started listening in on our conversation. Two people got banned over two different days. Other people started getting warnings for shit like, I fucking hate beer. That's it. That's all they said. I fucking hate beer. They got a warning. Bah! Like in real time. You are breaking community guidelines, da 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 da. I was like, fuck this shit. Fuck it. Get the fuck off of this shit. What the fuck is that? Bullshit. It's bullshit, I tell you. I was very, very unhappy about it. All right, what do I got to do here? I tell you what I got to do. I got to go pull up my sponsors. They got some new, beer. Oh, yes, I'm 21. All right. First of all, this podcast is brought to you by Nuclear Blast. Nuclear Blast is the premier heavy metal label throughout the universe. They have got all kinds of awesome bands. They've got a built-in massive warehouse in Germany, massive warehouse in America, and it's chock full of delicious physical product. They have got bands like Testament, Chuck Billy's band that I'm about to interview right here in the future. They got all kinds of vinyl by Testament, old school shit, new school shit. They have got Machine Head. They've got Nightwish. They've got Madball. They've got all kinds of good. They got Meshuggah. They got a sick Meshuggah set. They've got an Opeth. They've got ridiculous Opeth packages, deluxe packaging, you know, box sets, awesome vinyl. Head over to Nuclear Blast. .com. There's also a European one that I think is like nuclearblast.eu or something. Google that shit. You'll find it. They got some awesome, awesome, awesome stuff. This podcast is put out to you on the Gas Digital Network. Gas Digital has some awesome podcasts. They've got political podcasts, news podcasts. They've got funny shit like Legion of Skanks. They've got the Josta podcast. And they got your boy right here, the General, No Fucking Regrets. If you are interested in listening to any of the episodes from the first 25 episodes that I did, I think I'm coming up on number 50 here. And if you want to subscribe, you can actually subscribe right now using code NFR. NFR gets you the first 14 days free. Here's how I rolled my tongue like that. Free. gets you free for free 99. That's right. My favorite price, free 99. And you get the first 14 days for free, and then you get a dollar off of the subscription for a year. You get a dollar off, and you get access to all the stuff. You can hang out there. You know, people ask me all the time, how can we support your band? You know, you're not on tour, fucking crazy COVID fucking mania, all this shit. That is a way. Subscribe to my Twitch channel whenever it fucking happens. But right now, you can subscribe to No Fucking Regrets. Have all that access. You get the podcast early, 2 days before everybody else. And yeah, check it out. Check it out. It is also, my sponsor is the one and only, the mighty, mighty, mighty Altamont Beer Works. Altamont Beer Works are located in Livermore, California. And let me just tell you before I go any farther, they deliver all throughout California. And right now, they're even having a sale. They're having a sale on beer. Beer sale. Get the fuck out of here. Yeah, for real. They are having a sale on beer. They deliver throughout all of California. So if you use the code NFR, no fucking regrets, you can get 10% off of the beer, and you can get it delivered right to your establishment, right to your work. If you're having a work party, you can get it right to your house. They got some good shit. I would recommend getting a case if I were you. Just makes it more worthwhile. They're out of the green collar right now. I'm looking at it. They sold out of some beers. They sold out of the A's beer. The Altamont A's beer. This pale is clean, easy drinking, touch of malt. I shouldn't even read it to you because it's torture, right? Torture. You can't even buy it. Let me see. They got a new one that I just saw them pushing today I loved it. I was like, that's the fucking best shit. Oh, they got a Dank Row. Like the Death Row, like Death Row Records. They got Dank Row beer, a sticky, icky, crushable IPA created and brewed by our brewer Norby. This beer is light in body and color. It's made up of 100% RAR 2 Row base malt. I don't know what that means. And the dankiest of danky hops, which include experimental hop 07270, Summit and Columbus, low bitterness, bursting with hop flavor and aroma. That's a good one. They got all kinds of weed-themed beers because they're so hoppy, bro. That shit's so hoppy. They got Smokin' Dank. Comes in a 4-pack, as all of their beers do. They're like the 20-ounce cans in a 4-pack. Crafted for our fellow hopheads and stoners, this triple IPA. Not a single IPA. Not a double IPA. A triple, my friends. Triple IPA features the most danky, resinous hop blend that delivers a mouthful of herbaceous elixir, 11% ABV. Not fucking around. You smoke some weed and you drink that shit, you're going to be high and drunk as a motherfucker. They got Citra Fuel. Lots of IPAs. All again, 4-pack. It's on sale. Normally $16, $14. 100% Citra hops fuel this hop-forward India Pale Lager. That's right. So it's an India Pale Lager, not an ale, but a lager. Light and ultra-refreshing with notes of melon and passion fruit. For you who are too passionate. 6-point like Shotrod Rodrigo, who is much too passionate. And then they got my fave, you know me. I am on a stout kick. I am on a total fucking stout kick. Been going rolling hard on the stouts. I got the Nutty Operator. That's my jam right there. Nutty Operator is a peanut butter version of Smooth Operator, a smooth, rich, full-bodied oatmeal stout, heavy on the oats and chocolate malt. Complex beer balances out with a medium roast character followed by huge flavors and aromas of peanut butter. 5.8 ABV, no peanut allergy warning. You don't got to worry about it. Again, they deliver. They got some dope-ass merchandise. They got fucking glasses. They got enamel camper cups. They got some Mac Drizzy shit. You got to check them out. They sell crowlers, all kinds of good shit. Yeah, check their whole thing out. Oh, they got a whole full beer list. This might be stuff that that they don't have anymore, though. Might be stuff they don't have anymore. So I don't know. But I tell you what, check them out. Again, NFR is the code. Gets you 10% off. Boom. All right. All right. How we doing, Twitch twats? I always found stout really bitter. It is. I love that bitter. I love that bitter. A machine hophead IPA. That's right. I'm all about it. All about it. about it, man. Anyway, let's get into the podcast here. Check this out. So back in the day, me and Craig LeCicero, Forbidden the Thrash Band. He lived across the street from a high school, or not a high school, it's like a junior high or maybe even an elementary. And we used to practice at his house. And so we'd go over there and we'd practice in his garage. And then we'd go talk somebody into buying beer for us. And then, because we weren't old enough to drink, we'd get that. And then we'd go across the street and we'd just listen to thrash bands in this, once school was out, in the little kind of basketball area. And there was a park like Jungle Gym and stuff. And we'd kick it there and we'd listen to music on a boombox. We'd listen to Exodus and we'd listen to Slayer and we'd listen to all kinds of band. Well, let me tell you, when this shit dropped, when the fucking Legacy demo dropped, this shit was sick. Like, we were just like, oh my God. I even talk about this on the podcast. But I tell you what I didn't do on the podcast, I didn't play the song, because this is the song that opened the demo. And we were like, oh my God, these motherfuckers are sick right here. We had this right here. Burnt Offerings. Skolnick killing it. Listen to the sweep coming up. This is what Zetro's singing. Before Zedro was in Exodus, this is when he was in Legacy. But this is the first shit we heard. And this is Testament. All these songs, same lyrics, same everything. And this is a fucking demo. This is heavy as fuck. You know, this is a fucking heavy fucking demo. Production's guitar tone killer. Right there, though. But then I tell you what, when this shit dropped, when the album dropped, we were like, oh my God, because then the next thing that came was this right here. This is the album. This is Testament, the Legacy, Over the Wall. This song. Then we got Into the Pit. This is off the next record, though. This is off of the New Order right here. Into the Pit was always a banger. This shit fucking crushed the pit. Ooh, Phaser. I'll tell you what, though, this next song that I'm going to play for you, when we were on tour with them, Violence toured with Testament, we were the opener, and this next song I'm going to play for you. So the chorus right there. Into the pit. This shit, though, this shit crushed it. Cool intro, but, like, I'm going to skip to the heavy shit. Disciples of the Watch. This shit crushed it live. So good live.
burn you to the cross.
All death metal on tour, shit. Shit was sick. And then this is, they dropped this shit, and this was like, Testament was on their way, man. This record dropped like you couldn't escape Testament at this point. Everywhere you look, Testament, 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 Testament.
One though, I remember when this record first dropped, I was kind of like, I don't know, but this song is fucking awesome. Title track off of their fourth album. Chuck's got some great stories about this record. Then Testament came and fucking threw us all a curveball and dropped this shit. And everybody's like, what? Oh, shit. Fucking came with some fucking death metal shit. Dogface Gods. And it was like, what? Tune down. Chuck singing really low. This is a banger. Low. Off a low. This shit's a rager. Demonic ritual. That's fucking heavy. That's heavy. Dude. Heavy. Sorry, demonic refusal. I had my glasses off. My glasses were off. I couldn't read what that said. And then they got this banger off of The Gathering, 1999.
Right. tell you what. They dropped a new record. No, wait. I got to play this one. This one. This shit. They came back after a long hiatus, and they dropped this album, and I remember hearing this song and being like, oh my God, this shit's fucking so good. Fucking rocking. I think Paul Bostaff on drums. Slayer. X forbidden. Life in the world untold. Question the unknown. This record is really good. And this song is amazing. Love this song. This right here, latest album, Titans of Creation. This song is fucking awesome. This is a great song. Great chorus. Shit's heavy right there, motherfuckers. Ugh. That shit's heavy as fuck. I'm gonna get into this right now. Ladies and gentlemen, the mighty, mighty, mighty Chuck Billy from Testament. Chuck Billy.
What's up, Rob?
Fellow coronavirus survivor, how are you?
Man, I'm doing well, but every day I'm noticing things that, reoccurring things that, I try to stay off the internet and read all them forums, but Tiffany's all over it, finding out symptoms that are reoccurring. I guess they call you the long haulers now. And things that, really? I've happened. I'm just like, man, it's just not the same. I feel bad. I'm not sick, but I've been getting still a little headaches, lightheaded sometimes.
Oh, no shit, huh?
Just some things. And then Chip says, yep, that's a symptom. Yep, that's a symptom. That's one of the, things you get after. So, but besides that, I feel normal, feel great. Just, it's just kind of a weird emotion being stuck at home, stuck with no work, stuck.
Totally.
Trying to figure out what everybody else is doing. And, it's just a weird, weird dynamic all around,
It is, man. It's a weird time.
Yeah.
Just in general, but that makes it that much, that kind of suffocating. Like, I'm at home all the time. I don't have any plans for a long time. It's weird.
Well, it's kind of almost, in a weird kind of way, because us as musicians, we work hard and we're on tour a lot and we're gone from home and don't really get to enjoy summers at home with family and kids and all that kind of thing. So it's almost like taking full advantage of the opportunity right now to be home in the summer that I never really get to do, and events that happen through the year where I'm usually gone on the road and miss. So I'm sure same with you, that you're taking advantage of all these little extra things that we get to, enjoy until we get back to normalcy. Yeah. That's a positive, that a way I'm looking at it.
For sure. No, for sure. I totally agree. And there's been so many great things that have kind of happened with just being forced to slow down in a lot of ways.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm sure like everybody out there who's cleaned out every closet and every drawer and every part of their garage, looking for things to do. And, it's kind of weird. I actually found myself bored and found a lot of stuff that I've collected over a long time and decided, keep saying I'm going to sell this stuff and let somebody else enjoy it. And I had some time to get it together and organize it and, you know, get rid of some stuff. And, you know, fans are enjoying it and it's keeping me busy and, you know, kind of trying to stay busy all the time.
Yeah, for sure. When did the coronavirus hit you while you were on tour? So you were sick on tour?
I would have to say, I don't think I was, because when I got home, you know, I went and seen some friends and, you know, for one day, I was fine for one day. I got home Thursday night. Tiffany was sick by Friday morning. I was sick by Saturday morning, but by Friday I was fine. And I seen some friends and visited, and I thought, oh no, once I found out I was sick, I better call them and let everybody know. And everybody I was around didn't get sick. So I'd have to say at that point, maybe I wasn't contagious yet, I guess. But, you know, who really knows? Because they say, you know, you're 2 to 14 days contagious, you know, prior to being sick. And so, but, you know, it hit me hard on that Saturday when, you know, I seen everybody on Friday and they all did get sick. So who knows, you know?
It was a pretty, was it a brutal one, or was it one of the easier ones, or?
Well, put it this way. I usually don't get sick that often, really, you know, and if I really like don't go down with bad flus for like weeks, you know? So when this hit me, it kind of dropped me. I mean, I thought, of course, you know, we just been on tour for 5 weeks, coming home in 6 weeks, you know, of course your body's achy, everything breaks down, you're tired. And I thought it was that, you know, we're just home and tired. And then next, you know, Tiff went down and then I went down, and I went down hard and quickly realized after communicating with all the other bands and crews that all of us had some similar symptoms. And we said, we got to have it, you know, right away. And it was kind of weird, because we got home and seeing the news and what everybody's feelings were, right away we're like, let's be proactive. Let's call our doctor and let's find out where we can go get tested. You know, we just got home from Europe, you know. So right away it was actually tough getting a test at first through our doctors. Like, well, are you sick? Do you have any symptoms? Like, well, no, but, you know, we've been through Europe all over, flew through the airport. And yeah, of course I want to get tested. And at first, like, well, until you show some symptoms, we were not going to test you. And I thought that was ridiculous, you know. And so by Sunday, when I was sick, Tiffany was feeling worse, we decided to call the doctor back and said, you know, now we feel awful, you know, so now go in and take the test, you know. And it was a bad, I mean, I like I said, I don't get sick for a long time, and I was down for a good 2 weeks. I mean, down hard, where I just couldn't wake up, you know, and just couldn't sleep late at night, just achy body, headache. You know, and it was a weird sickness, because of course you're looking at the world stop in the TV and you're sick as fuck and you're just going, what's going on, you know? And I got what the world's worried about. Here I am sick. And then to hear Will, I was like, oh my God, no way, you know, going to the hospital. And that was a scary moment for everybody.
Scary.
You know, just right when I first heard that, I got short of breath. I was like, oh, you know, you think in your head, am I going to have problems breathing now as well? And I kind of was like right away, like hit you, you know, like, man.
Yeah.
And, you know, and we all just really stayed in contact with each other, because nobody knew of what symptoms to look for, what was coming up. So you're kind of just finding out as you go, you know, what you're getting, what people are finding.
Especially at that point, because you got it. I mean, that was March. Like, nobody, like, we know a lot more. Like, March seems like 2 years ago, like, at this point. Like, we know so much more about stuff. But at that point, it was like, barely, that was like a word that was just kind of starting to come into the.
Yeah. And of course, the public. First thing everybody's saying is, at first, and especially this, oh, if you get it, you're not going to get it again. I'm like, oh, great. You know, but that wasn't the truth. And we found out just talking to the doctors that no, there's been cases of people getting it again. And now like Tiffany, she started going to Stanford to donate her plasma. And she went in there and her plasma looked great, the first donation. And they said, well, we can use this for 4 people to, you know, help. And she was excited. She's going to come back. But she got a call in that next week saying, hey, you know, your levels now, the antibodies are going down. So stop donating. You need what you have. And then later on after that, we've had some more reports hearing that people have went and retested and have no signs of the antibodies. Like they've just diminished instead of multiplied as we thought was going to happen. Yeah. And I've even had some friends who have tested twice negative and then finally said, I feel so bad, and went to a third one and tested positive. So it's just crazy. You know, you really just don't know. It's just, I guess the best thing to do is just watch who you're around and wear a mask when you're in public. And I've really tried not to really go out too much if I have to, you know.
Yeah.
Definitely at gatherings, I'm staying away. Just, you know, but that's all we can do. Just doing my part, I guess, you know. But I don't want to get sick again. And you know, that's for sure.
I mean, we were on tour. We went through New York on February 4th. And, you know, that was the epicenter at that point in time, which we didn't know, which nobody knew at that point. This is like 5 weeks before the shutdown. But like five days after that, every single person in the band and crew was just leveled. Like I was sleeping 17 hours and still couldn't climb out of bed.
I remember reading that. Yeah.
It was just, we had to cancel a couple of shows. I did one show in between the two. They were canceled because it was Chicago. It was sold out. I was like, fuck. You know, it was like an out-of-body experience trying to get through that. You know, we're playing for 3.5 hours. I was like, fuck. But we got through it, and, you know.
Have you just had the rest of the guys, tests since?
I haven't. You know what? It's been the hardest. My tour manager, who was also as sick as we were, you know, Logan was sick. Logan was, you know, Logan is like probably the most fit dude I know in my whole life. Like, dude is, you know, 2% body fat, and like he was gone, like just shot as I was. And our tour manager, he was sick the whole time. He went right to the hospital when he got back, and he tested positive for coronavirus. So I'm like, you had the same thing the entire time we did. So it was obviously that. Right. Like I haven't been that sick in a decade, like where I was just leveled. And you know what, my stepmom passed away, and so I went to be with my dad for a week, and she died under kind of crazy circumstances, and my dad had very similar he had coronavirus symptoms. And so I went there, and I was fine, and we were fine. I was just, you know, taking care. I was just being there for him. It was very hard for him. He was devastated. And then I came back, and I was like, I want to get tested, just because if what she died from was the coronavirus, I could have been exposed again. I went to the hospital at Kaiser, and they were like, well, do you have symptoms? I was like, no. And I was like, well, you know, I just kind of, you know, insisted on getting tested. And so I went to five different steps, and I'm finally in the quarantine tent, and fucking, like, you know, you just feel like you're in fucking Russia or something.
All right.
And the dude finally comes out, and he's like, are you having symptoms? Like, no, but, you know, my stepmom just died under very, you know, bizarre circumstances. I just want to get tested. So if I am, I can take myself out of the, you know, quarantine myself and not, you know, I just want to be a good citizen and take myself out of the mix here. And he was like, well, he's like, I just don't know. And I was like, look, I'd really like to get tested. Can you just test me? He's like, look, sir, there's 400 tests for all of Northern California. And I was like, what? I'm like, dude, there's 20 million people in Northern California. He's like, that's right. And there's 400 tests, and I can't waste a test on somebody who doesn't have symptoms. It's like, holy shit. So
crazy.
I tried to get the antibody test, couldn't get it. I then went and I just went camping, and, you know, just because it was the first time I'd really exposed myself, came back, got a test. It took 18 days for the test results to come back. Yeah. 18 days, dude. I was like, what the fuck? Like, so I don't know. Like, it's fucking crazy over here.
I just don't think ever the world was prepared for this, you know, as far as, you know, being ready for everybody to get vaccinated, you know. And it's crazy, you know. I mean, especially now knowing more and more and more about it, like, I'm sure if you went and did the antibody test, I mean, who knows, you might not have any. It's been so long, you know, and not even know now it's been so long. So I mean, we really just don't know, you know.
Yeah, well, glad you're still here, glad you survived it.
Yeah, man, we're at that's not taking me down.
right. Like, other things have tried and failed.
Everything's tried, yeah. Speaking of that, today is actually the 19th year anniversary of the Thrash of the Titans benefit show. Is today?
Is it really?
19 years ago to not today. Yeah.
Oh, so shit. That was, that's awesome.
Big Bay Area moment, you know.
That really was. I want to get into that with you. I totally want to get into that with you later. That was a big deal, man.
Yeah, that was. For us, and it was as well, you know. So it's just, you know, it's a big deal.
For sure. I mean, and, you know, shout out to Will Carroll for pulling through. That was fucking scary. Jesus Christ.
Yeah, man. And I'm so glad to see that he's really, like, you know, I see that he's living a healthy life and trying to be a little healthier and just, you know, I guess you just can't take life for granted and just, you know, live for the moment every day. It could be, you know, so I'm so happy he's just moving positive now and living and just enjoying life, and it's the way it should be, you know.
Totally. Yeah, I mean, 12 days he was in a coma. I mean, that's fucking, dude, that's terrifying. Like, I can't even fucking imagine,
you know? Crazy.
Yeah.
No. Yeah, I woke up with one of those tubes down my throat, and it's not a good feeling. You know. Yeah, it's terrible. Right.
I want to get into I wanted to go back to, like, young Chuck Billy.
And
I was doing
trouble. trouble.
You did have I was doing some research on you, and I was listening to a podcast where you're talking about how you know, you had older and younger brothers, and they were all kind of, you know, some guys were playing guitar, like one of your brothers could play guitar and harmonica, and you, like, for you it was very fascinating to, like, the music aspect of it. Who was that?
My oldest brother, Brian, he was into, like, Crosby, Stills, Nash and that kind of stuff. So he was always had the acoustic and the harmonica and be singing, playing the harmonica and playing. And I was fascinated. That's what kind of got me inspired by, wow, that's cool. He's actually making music. And he inspired me and my brother, you know, basically. And we were the ones that were finding his records and putting them on and finding Cream and Stones and just,
oh, rad.
You know, a lot of early stuff that he was into.
Yeah. That's, do you remember, like, some, were you liking the, like, that kind of folk stuff? Like, the, well, Crosby,
biggest,
Stills, and Nash?
The biggest thing I liked was Crosby, Stills, Nash and Young. He played that a lot. And it was just the songs, the acoustic was soothing and catchy. And I was just like, and now when I hear that music, it really takes me back to a time with me and my brother back then and remembering those good times, you know, and those days listening to music and records and watching them play guitar, you know.
Yeah.
So, yeah,
that's rad. That's awesome. You know what, can you adjust your earbuds? Something's crackling a lot, like really crackling. There you go. That might be it. I think so.
All right.
So you discover Kiss at some point.
Well,
and this is not from your brother.
No.
Is this for your brother? Yeah.
Well, there was a battle between my brother, older brothers, and me and my younger brothers, Andy and Eddie, because we were the younger generation listening to Kiss posters while they had the Led Zeppelin and they had their right. posters. So there was this battle, you know, ripping dim posters. It was like...
You were ripping each other's posters down.
We were ripping each other's posters down, writing on them and just, you know, destroying each other's posters. So, you know, we were defending Kiss. He thought Kiss was absolute joke with the makeup and the music and the whole right. thing, and called them sissies and what are you doing? And, you know, it pissed me off, you know? And so I took a stance and destroyed their posters and, got my ass beat, but that's the way it went. And fortunately I had, you know, I was a big Kiss fan young and I went to my first concert. My aunt took my two cousins and me, and I believe it was like 1974, I believe. And I was only, I think, 12 years old, 13 years old, and they dropped us off, three kids off at Winterland. At Winterland. Dropped us off.
We'll pick you back up. Winterland.
Yeah, we'll pick right. you back up at after the show.
That's and I insane, think back, right?
Can you imagine nowadays dropping, you know, your 12, 13-year-old kids but San Francisco right. and Patrick's and even marijuana. There was all this pot smoke going around us, and we were just kids, and we're like, what is that? You know, I think we even got a contact, but that was the moment I kind of said, wow, this is cool, you know, and just, and Gene Simmons just blew my mind, you know, the, who he was and his persona up there. And I think that's kind of, every kid probably has the same story, but it's something inspiring about the entertainment factor of it, you know?
I mean, I think that's amazing that you saw him at such a small venue for the first time.
Oh yeah.
You know, that's like a, you know, 1500, 2000 seater or something.
It's crazy, man. But me and my cousins talk about it. Like, remember when your mom dropped us off? It's like, you know, right. Yeah. But you know,
at 12.
Yeah. 12. Yeah. Well, my older cousin, she was 14. So she was watching us.
That's cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's that was like your Beatles on Ed Sullivan moment. You know, you always hear the older rockers talk about they saw the Beatles on Ed Sullivan. This was your Beatles on Ed Sullivan moment.
Well, I've been defended them all up to that and haven't had to see in the videos and everything, but the live experience was like, yep, yeah, and that was it. I'd always been a Kiss fan, but that kind of turned me on to also just introduce me, I guess, a darker music or music that's just, you know, on the right side than the left, I guess, you know, a little more darker imagery and stuff. And I guess what kind of caught any young kid at that time was going against the grain and, you know, being rebellious and, you know, your parents hated it, so you loved it more. And
right. You know, your brothers hated it.
Brothers so you hated loved it, more. So you loved it more. Yeah. So, you know, that's what it was for me, that. And so, you know, I had an experience, I think it was around Souls of Black or The Ritual somewhere. I had an opportunity to go write a song with Gene Simmons.
Oh,
so
shit.
I flew down to LA and I met him up in the hills at a restaurant for breakfast. And it was first time meeting him, blew me away. And
were you nervous?
I was very nervous. I mean, sitting down one-on-one with Gene Simmons, you know.
And this is like a cult. This is your first time meeting, right? Like,
yeah. Yeah. And we're going to have breakfast, of course, of all things. So, and a little story about breakfast. We're having breakfast. We're talking. And he was just, you know, real Gene Simmons. And, you know, I was just like, wow, here I am. And in the middle of breakfast, he gets up, walks, didn't say anything to me, just gets up, walks to the table behind us, goes over with his fork, and he starts picking at the guy's food. His breakfast and helps himself to like a bite. And the guy goes, Hey, what are you doing? He goes, well, you're over here smoking your cigarette and I'm in sharing your cigarette with me. So I thought I'd go over here and you'd share your breakfast with me too.
Oh my God. That's yeah, fucking swear great. To God.
And I'm just sitting here going, oh my God, Gene just called this guy out on his cigarette right here at breakfast. And it was the best thing. And then he just calmly comes back. Gene sits down. Starts back at his breakfast. And here I am. You know, like, wow. Oh my God. I didn't know what to say. I was just like, didn't know to laugh or to, I was just like, what happened?
Were you like, good for you?
Well, I was, but it was just like, interesting.
Right.
And so then I went down to Gene's house after breakfast and went to the room you always see with all his toys and everything in there, his little studio above the garage. And we go in there and we sit down and the first thing he tells me, he goes, yeah, Chuck, you know, and this is, I had read and stuff. He'd been big Smashing Pumpkins fan at the time and stuff. And yeah, Chuck, you know, I got to tell you, know, I think rock and roll and heavy metal's dead. And I was just like, a puppy went, like, he just like flattened me. I'm like, right. Oh, my hero is just crushing me right now. Oh my God, Gene, you just didn't say that to me. You know, I was like, almost like,
just stop, Gene. Just stop.
I pretty much, and at that point, I just really said, "Well, Gene, that sucks, but it's not dead. But I don't think I could write a song with you, you know, because I think the conversation and the meeting and everything stopped like right then. I was done with my meeting because metal's not dead and rock and roll ain't dead, Gene, and." I pretty much said, thanks for having me. And you know, it was great having breakfast and maybe we'll see each other out. And I left.
Holy crap. Yeah. You're so offended by him saying that metal was dead. Like,
I was so offended that he said metal was dead. And he was a big Smashing Pumpkins fan. I felt like, said, but you love Smashing Pumpkins. Oh my God. You know? And I was like, I love Smashing Pumpkins now. Don't get me wrong. But at the time I was like, what? You know, no, you know?
Right.
But you know, so that was my like Gene introduction, Kiss highlight letdown, I guess. But I see Gene
never met your heroes.
Yeah, but I met Gene and Paul after that. They came to some shows. We played like down and played them Hollywood, and he remembers it and the whole thing. But you know, he was friendly, and we were just like, you know, it was just one of those things after that, you know, it just wasn't meant to be.
I know. I mean, why would you be reaching out to Chuck Billy of Testament to, like, and if you're not trying to write some like fucking hard rock metal song, you know, like for fuck's sake, like reach out to Billy Corgan if you think it's dead and you want to write some other shit, but like right now to you.
Yeah. So that was my hero's experience, but I still love him because, you know, he's just an icon and, you know, and the way he carried himself in person was just mind blowing, you know. Just,
what a character, right?
Yeah, like, yeah, right. I mean, gets up and
I've never even thought to do that to somebody. Like,
he's like, you're sharing your smoke with me, so I thought, you know, you're sharing your breakfast as well.
Right.
Oh, it's great. But of course, Gene, he's such a wit, you know. I just, you know.
Did you tell him about seeing him at the Winterland or the Fillmore? I mean,
oh yeah, I told him all about my stories, the backyard with the tennis rackets and the garage and all this, putting on, doing the band and the show, and you know the whole thing, you know, putting on the show for the neighborhood, you know, all my Kiss adventures, you know, the poster stories, just the defending of, you know, the whole thing, man. That was my moment.
That's awesome. That's awesome that you got. It's awesome you got to share that. You know what I mean? Like, some people don't ever get to share that. You know,
no,
like,
not at all.
You know, that you that let him know just the impact that he had, his music, his, you know, vibe, the whole trip.
Yeah, and it's fortunate I've been really blessed actually that I've been able to do that with a lot of my heroes, from Ronnie James Dio to Halford, and you know, same thing, meeting them and you know, just going. Them being who they are and the way they carry themselves, and just blew me away that I could call them friends, you know?
right. Totally. So you're playing, you start playing Kiss shows in your backyard around this time?
Yeah, we're doing Kiss in the backyard and in the garage.
Are you living in Dublin at this time?
In Dublin, okay. Yeah.
All right.
And we have a big neighborhood, so there was always something going on, but the show, we'd have the garage close and open the door, and we'd have the lights and do the whole thing.
Oh, nice. And a bunch of kids from the neighborhood would
the
just
kids
hang it
come up. We'd have our flyers and, you know, Kisses playing at 6 at Billy House. And,
nice.
Yeah.
And all the kids would just hang out on the driveway and watch.
Yeah. I mean, that or the backyard, we'd do shows in the back and, you know, just.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
That's cool. Your parents were, you know, letting that happen.
Yeah, I mean, we had pretty much an active life of my parents let us, you know, I think everybody, it's different generation where kids used to run the streets, you know, your mom would say, just be home when the street lights come on. I was like, all right, that's easy enough. You know,
did your parents get did they get Kiss? I mean, that like Kiss at that time would have been viewed as pretty, you know, Knights in Satan's Service and, you know, kind of evil.
My mom hated it. The posters, Chuck, you know, because she was very religious. My father, he really didn't care. He's a sports guy, you know. It's, you know, he just didn't pay attention to any of that part of it. But my mom, she really didn't like it. Just, she didn't like Gene and the tongue and the blood and all that. So she's, yeah, she didn't care for Gene.
And you would just, and you would go up there and you were singing? Like you were the singer of the band?
I was being Gene. I was playing bass.
Okay, right, yeah.
I was, so you had bass too, okay. And singing. All right. But, you know, the high step and the whole thing, you know.
Sweet. I didn't know you played bass. I don't think I've ever seen you with a guitar.
Yeah, I mean, I started out as a guitar player. I mean, I played guitar from like seventh grade through about my senior year. And once I started singing and realized I'm not that good at a guitar player, and I probably, you know, probably not that good of a singer, but I'll give it a shot. I kind of stopped playing guitar, really. And I pick it up every now and then at home just to play the same chords I probably played 30 years ago, you know.
Right.
But you know, that's it's weird because when I wanted to be a musician, I wanted to be a guitar player, and I was all the music I've ever listened to and drove me was, you know, the Priests and, you know, the Maidens and Scorpions, but it was always guitar driven riff music that I was always inspired to. And I really didn't pay attention to the vocals. It's weird. As I, the years went on, as I became a vocalist, I still didn't pay attention till I would say, I don't know, maybe in the last 10 years, I've really kind of paid more attention to vocalists and things as lyrics and more patterns, I guess, and stuff. Maybe it's helped me out a little more, but I've never really paid attention to that. I always was guitar driven. You know, person, you know, so it's,
yeah,
it's kind of weird the way I kind of evolved to what I kind of what I do.
I hear you. My wife always makes fun of me because I'm the worst rememberer of lyrics, like of our entire family. Like I can't remember, you know, I can remember the melody. I can remember the riff like a motherfucker, but like,
yeah, I mean, I have a problem. I still, y'all admit it. I use a teleprompter, but I use it mostly when I'm starting a tour or I got new material that I need to make sure I get it right. And then once I get it, I don't really use it out there. It's there, but I you know, I'm comfortable by the time, you know, a week or two into the tour, you know, but, you know, I'm very bad at remembering other people's lyrics, you know, and we do a lot of stuff that Metal Allegiance or any, you know, benefit shows. I'm really bad at it. So I've always like need that little security blanket because I just have a problem remembering lyrics. But it's funny, again, like I go back, I'm actually getting better at remembering lyrics of other people because I'm paying attention.
yeah that's what I'm saying, like I don't know if I was just paying attention and then, or I just make up some other lyric and that's what I thought it was for 10 years, and I was like, right. Oh wait, that's what the word is, oh fuck,
right, exactly. I know.
You had a pretty fearsome reputation when you were a teenager. You know, like even like my kind of young Fremont, you know, I was living in Fremont at the time, we had moved to Fremont, you know, but like the Chuck Billy that kind of went on to be in Testament, you know, even the lore of what you kind of going around Dublin and being crazy. And, well, you know,
I'll admit it. I mean, it was really more of a Chuck Bully than Billy, because I was, I mean, I grew up as like more in sports and competitive and athletic, and I was always bigger than the other kids, it seemed like. And, you know, I grew up a little scrapper, you know, so I wasn't afraid to fight and throw it down. And as I grew up and was drinking and became this little beer drinker hellraiser, and kind of that's what it was. And I think once I got into the band, I found out a little more responsibility, and I got to kind of maybe mellow out and not be that guy. You know, but I still admit that I was that guy, you know, and
there was a rumor that you would go around scalping people, which means you would come up and cut the ponytails off of dudes or something. Is this true?
Well, I did that. Yeah. And, but, you know,
yeah, I did that. Yeah.
You remember Rick Ratto from Diamond? Remember the band Diamond? Michael Galina, Rick Ratto, Willie Lang was in the band. They had a band.
I know Willie Lang.
We had a band in the Bay Area. It had to be 83, 84, somewhere around there. And Danny Gill was a guitar player. And they were like an upcoming kind of like a Van Halen band. And at that time, I think I'd just started like taking lessons and doing all this stuff. And Willie was in the group. And he had mentioned that, you know, talking shit, you know, Chuck can't sing. He should never be a singer, this and that. And so, really? Willie's talking shit, huh? So you shouldn't have told me that. So next thing you know, me and my friend Jimmy Christensen, another big guy out of Dublin, we had a keg, and we were drinkers. So we had a keg from a party the night before. So we had a keg in the back of the car, and we're drinking going down
in the back of the car.
In the back of the car, drinking straight from awesome. The tap, going to their studio down in Berkeley. It's right on above Hicks Appliance in Berkeley. So we go out there. We know they're rehearsing, and we pull up, and Willie knows we're out there. And speaking of, I had my scissors in one hand. I had actually a bottle of Nair in the other back pocket.
Oh my God.
And he prided himself in his hair. It was fully long down to his waist. And that was his pride, you know, and I was about to take it from him. So I go down there and Willie, you know, looks out the window, sees us down there, open the door, you know, so he opens the door and we rush the place and we go in there and shit went down and, yeah, I grabbed all his hair, wrapped it up, clipped it off with the scissors, you know, and he's this, you know, oh my God, looking up. And he was actually, I found him in the office and he was actually on the phone with his girlfriend. And I just remember screaming and a girl going, Rick, what's going on? And as I was cutting his hair. So I did some pretty bad shit when I was a kid. You know, I can go on so many stories, but you know, it's who I was growing up back when I was younger. I think I kind of, once I, you know, came an adult and had responsibilities and Cody came part of my life and Tiffany, it just kind of, you know.
Yeah. What's kind of funny though, is that like you ended up becoming incredibly like a lifelong friend with Willie.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, I mean, like you ended up working for his family, right?
Yeah. I mean, Willie, I mean that he was in our first band Rampage with me, him and my brother and stuff. And that was the first.
And this is
band
after that? This is after that?
No, we had Rampage in 1982 or three. This was before. This was my very first. I was like really young then.
Okay.
Willie had just left Diamond to join Lodge Rocket. And well, he left Rampage, joined Diamond to Lodge Rocket.
Okay. Oh, gotcha. Okay.
And then on from there. So, yeah. But me and Willie, you know, we were friends from Dublin from playing sports. You know, me and Willie knew each other from baseball. Willie was like one of the like best pitchers in the baseball is a little league team, but he was like one of the best pitchers, and my dad was a coach and we played against each other, and that's really how we met, is through sports. And then years through high school, I kind of knew of him, and then getting out of high school, because he was the burnout hanging in the parking lot and I kind of hung in the parking lot, and we kind of met and through music, and there was a lot of barn parties and stuff going on. We kind of met through music, and then he started a band with my younger brother. And then that's kind of how I kind of really got really close, is when I joined Rampage because they needed a singer. And that's when I decided, okay, I'm not playing guitar. I'm going to be a singer now. I better figure out what to do.
Is it with Eddie Billy?
My buddy, brother Andy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And so then right after that, I went to college and so how do I learn how to sing, and started taking vocal training and private lessons and stuff and tried to figure it out.
Oh, shit. Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome. That's killer that you were doing that even back then. I mean, that's like you're still like a teenager, right?
Yeah, but I didn't, because I was thrown in the spot. I sang at the rehearsal one day because they all sang in the band. And one day they said, hey, Chuck, here, you sing today. And I said, all right, because me and Zett actually used to go to rehearsals. And we were kind of like the roadies, and we and Zett used to beat each other up and pound each other in the back of a 40-foot semi while they rehearsed.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, and, funny.
yeah. Because Zett was best friends with my younger brother. That's how I met Zett.
Oh, okay.
And everybody.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Crazy. So, yeah, it was crazy. So that's how we all met, you know, me, Zett, and, my, you know, Rampage thing.
He was, Zett was friends with Andy.
Yeah.
Who was in Rampage. Okay, gotcha.
Yeah. And then Zett had the car and he would drive us out to Oakland to rehearse. And that's kind of how it all started for us. And when we were just thrashing one night, Zett didn't sing at all then yet, but he was always singing Maiden. He always was a singer. But at that rehearsal, they said, here, Chuck, you sing. And that's the night I sang. And they said, you know, hey, okay, you're the new singer. And I'm like, okay.
You're like, all right, you seem like you're the singer.
Yeah. So I said, all right, I'll do it. And then, so that's that day I kind of decided I learned how to sing and kind of put down the guitar.
Yeah. And you start taking, you're in high school, you're taking lessons and like,
Well, I was out of high school.
You were going to college? Okay,
well, I
gotcha.
Was right out of high school. So it was like a year and a half out of high school. I went to Chabot College actually. And for about a year and a half and took guitar lessons there, some singing lessons. And that same year I was going out to San Francisco to take some private lessons off a teacher. And shortly after that, I was taking some group lessons out in Berkeley off a gal, Judy Davis, who's a pretty famous instructor. And
are you guys doing shows? Are you guys playing shows around this?
Yeah, I was just singing, learning how to sing, doing Rampage. We never really did shows. We did it like the stage in Danville and some parties. That's about it.
Yeah. But and like rehearsing and like you're in the garage
and that's a lot. It. Yeah. And that was it, but never really doing much. And then once I finished, like all my lessons, literally at the end of it, my teacher said, okay, well, this is about the end and, you know, you can get another instructor. I've kind of got to that point. I literally got a call from Zett saying, I need a singer for this band Legacy. If Alex Golnick could call. So he gave me Alex's number, and I said, okay, I'm ready to start to find a band. You know, I finished my lessons. I'm ready. You know, and
are you watching Legacy, like, kind of we went come
and
seen out? Them.
Me and Willie and Greg, I know, because we were supporting Zet, and we went, and that's where we met Eric and everybody the first time. And they were playing in Alameda. They did I forgot where they played. Zet was singing, and they all came out in priest suits and had priest collars on and shit, and right. upside down crosses and all this stuff.
Nice.
But when I heard the demo, you know, honestly, for me, because as you know, I kind of came from a different background at that point. I was just kind of introduced to more extreme metal, I guess. So
yeah, like Rampage and all that stuff wasn't thrash.
No, not at all. So like thrash kind of was kind of learning and just getting introduced to that stuff. And so when I heard Legacy stuff, it kind of was maybe a little over my head, I guess, a little bit, or fast. And but it was to me, because I was like, wow, this 14 and 16 year old kids are writing some pretty complex stuff, you know. And that's what caught my eye.
How young they were?
Yeah.
That's how young they were? Jesus Christ.
Yeah. And I was like, wow, that's what caught me. And so Zet said, you know, go for it. So I just kind of focused, mm-hmm. and, you know what, I'm going to do it. There's a three song demo. I got to learn these three songs and go audition. So I called Alex and set that up, and really sat and focused with Zet and listened to the demo over and over and over. And that was a whole different world for me, because I'd been taking these lessons for about a year and a half, trying to be melodic and melodies and all this stuff. And now I'm singing with timing. I've been a prisoner of captain myself. I've never had my life. I'm like, what the fuck's going on here? What? Where's the melody, you know? Over the wall. And I'm like, there's no melody here. You know, yeah. I just studied
They're
all
like,
this
we
stuff.
We don't want melody.
Yeah, that's what they said. There's no melody. We're not singing. And I'm like, okay, all right. So, you know, I kind of, you know, really was kind of thrown into this whole new genre that I was kind of learning. I was prepared to train to my voice to kind of know how to sing and know how to hold a melody, I guess, you know, and carry a tune. But this whole new timing was weird for me, trying to sing thrash metal or whatever they were doing at that time. And so Eric really did take me once I got into the band. And I at first when I did the audition, I went down to Jackson Street, and they had these really small rooms, and I actually with audition, I couldn't fit in the room. I put my PA in there, and I stood in the hallway in the door and sang in the hallway.
Just put my PA. The room was so small, it was so small. Already.
Yeah, so I just put the PA in there and stood in the hall.
And that was your audition?
That was my audition. You know, of course, I just came from Rampage, and I was jamming it for a minute in this guilt band with my brother Andy. We never did any shows, but, you know, of course, I had like a blonde streak in my hair and a feather earring and, you know, a leopard skin shirt. And they're like,
yeah, I was going to say, I kind of remember like you were like kind of glammy, like at first, right?
Yeah, I was kind of glammy, man. You know, Dockety. Okay, Dockety. So, and they're like, first of all, that guy can't dress like that. You know, he can't wear that shit. He's got to dye his hair, and he's got to wear a vest. I'm like, I could do that. You know, because I was kind of a biker. I was riding motorcycles, and I was like, you know, I was a little – I didn't see myself as a glam guy. I was kind of tougher and bigger, too big to be that guy, that glam guy.
Right, right.
So I'm like, you know what? I kind of fit into this a little bit. This is a little more biker and a little more – me, you know, so it fit. And then I just really kind of took that year under Eric's wing to really train on how to be a thrash singer, where I sing on timing. And I think after about 6 months, I kind of really picked it up. But then I really wanted to kind of still put my influence of what Zet did and try to put a little melody or a little flow instead of be so staccato with the words. And so I think that's kind of what I brought to Testament at the beginning, I think, carried out through, you know, from the beginning on, you know.
Yeah. No, I mean, I remember hearing, I was in Forbidden, and I was hanging out with Craig, and we'd go drink 40 ounces at the school across the street from his house, and we rocked that Legacy demo. Was fucking awesome. Like, yeah, it was fucking heavy, and like songs were killer, and it was, you know, it was kind of slayery, but it had like a Bay Area feel. And Alex, I mean, just Alex was fucking phenomenon. Like a phenomenon that all of us, jaws were on the floor. Like, holy shit. Like, no one had really brought in that classical, almost Yngwie style into thrash. You know, it kind of been more like blues based with Hammett and Mustaine and stuff like that. And this was just like, holy shit, like he just changed the game. It was really cool.
Well, I think a lot of that Satriani lessons that he had taken at that time probably really put a lot of that to him. You know, he really, really had clean licks and clean, you know, runs. You know, they weren't staggered or fumbled. You know, they're just so clean. He didn't need to put the distortion on it. I'd be like, holy shit, that's just, it's clean. You know, yeah. And I think super really, you know, from the day one I heard Alex and Eric play, that clean side of Alex is really at the beginning is what really set our tone for Testament Legacy at the time, because once Alex left the band, we really did change our sound to me. The blend wasn't there, where Eric has a really overdriven, distorted tone, where Alex really has a clean rhythm tone, but meshed together, it really sounds chunky because Alex is, you can really hear the notes of how clean Alex is playing. And that's what really worked. And I really noticed in 05 when Alex came back for the first rehearsal on the reunion, that was the first thing I noticed when he started playing. It was clean guitars and they played the guy. I'm like, there it is. And that's what I remember, man. That's it. And, you know, I'm so happy he found his way back. And,
you know, for sure. was he like the lead? I mean, if you're given the number to call Alex, is he kind of like the leader of the band at this point?
At that point, he was pretty much the I would say the, what's the word, responsible. The other guys are, you know, kid, and Alex was 15, but he was the responsible one.
Right.
And so he took the call, and I think they were working with Elliot Kahn as a lawyer, because Elliot was friends with
Alex. Oh, shit, they already had a lawyer. Yeah.
Well, Alex's father, you know, of course, is a law professor at UC Berkeley, and was friends with Elliot, kind of, I guess, mentored him and helped him through school. So he was kind of a friend of the family. And that's kind of how that worked. So Alex and Elliot kind of worked together with the contracts and stuff. So that's where Alex kind of fit in at the beginning of it, you know.
Who's more of the thrasher, Alex or Eric, at this point? Like, who's more into the thrash thing? Are they both there?
I think they're both there, but Eric was more of a darker, merciful fate all the way, you know, that kind of fate. And Eric was more punk, I think. He was more GBH and stuff like that, where Alex was the Ingway, you know, the guitar Orient sweeps kind of stuff, you know. You know, he was that guy. Because he totally has a different picking style than Eric, and he still does today, you know, and he'll kill me for it, but we still kind of get on him and say, dig in there, come on, dig in there a little bit, you know. But, you know.
It's the Bay Area. You got to have a scrape on every single down pick.
You got to scrape, and Eric gets on him a lot for that, but, you know, it's just the way it's got to be.
I remember this could have just been a rumor, but back in the day, like, there was a, you know, Ruthie's Inn was a famous club. I think rumor had it you had just joined the band and you go to Ruthie's, and I guess some of the, like, Toby Rage and Jeff Bovey and those guys start fucking with you, and you just beat the fuck out of them, and everybody was just like, holy shit, that glam dude from Testament just beat the shit out of the Slay Team dudes. Is this true, or is this just like a word on the street?
I don't remember the Ruthie's Inn one. I don't remember that, but I guarantee if there was a scrap, then it went down. I mean, I know I fought a lot at those clubs, but I do remember the big scrap was a Halloween scrap at up the street at Keystone Berkeley. In Berkeley. There was a Halloween show, and that's when Laws Rocket was playing, I remember, back then. That's when there was a big scrap where security fucked with us and all the Dublin guys, and we were all dressed up as the Baseball Fury at that show.
And so
the one main security guy is this, I don't remember him, but he's this big round dude that stood in front of the stage with this big beard, and he kept fucking with me, and I know Willie, and I'm up there like, yeah, and you know Willie's face, and he's like, get away from the band, quit touching the band. I'm like, quit touching me. And he kept, you know, I kept doing this, and he just kept touching me. And I said, hey, man, you touch me one more time, we got issues. And he did. And so I bellied to bellied him and grabbed him, wrapped my arms around him belly to belly, and just slammed his ass on the ground and just went at it. And all of a sudden, just everybody dogpiled, and we took on the whole security team and just pounded him. And, you know, and but it was funny because we're all sports guys from Dublin. And I don't know why. And you could still see
this would have been like that Dublin Death Patrol dudes. Yeah, okay.
Dublin Death Patrol. Everybody's 6 foot plus, you know,
right,
from Dublin. There's no short people. So it's like
it's like the Holland of the Bay Area.
It was. And so when we went to the shows in the Bay Area, it's like we felt like we're these big athletic crazy dudes that, you know, and we kind of use our force a little bit. But right. Yeah, I mean, there was a lot of scraps up there. I mean, I would say if somebody did try to fuck with us, we weren't going to take it. I guarantee that. You know, there was a lot of stuff going down. There was some fun stuff at Bailoff's house, some house wrecking parties that we went on with Death Patrol, and, you know, just crazy times. You know, there were some crazy parties back in those times.
I mean, when you join, it's still Legacy at this point. When you join Legacy, does the whole kind of thrash community kind of open up, like you're now entering this whole other world of Paul Bailoff and Gary Holt and Exodus and Death Angel? Now these people are coming into your life, right?
Oh, it's totally. It's you know, it's funny, Rob, is I did my Guilt demo, my very first ever recording I did for U.S. Metal, Mike Varney. I did on Shrapnel Records.
Oh, Shrapnel, nice.
And I sang this song Down to the City with my band Guilt, and next door Exodus was recording Bonded by Blood.
Oh, and shit.
I was hearing Katati, and I was up there, and I'm here screaming. I'm like, what the hell's going on over there? I'm like, oh, it's Exodus recording a new record. And so that was my first influence to meeting Exodus and that kind of music too.
Oh,
you know?
Wow. Okay.
To full How circle fucking, to next thing you know, what? Here I am, a singer in this kind of a scene, meeting Paul and all the guys in that movement and that band. And it was just kind of weird the way just that little circle kind of took for me from, you know.
Yeah, right.
Different world of music invading their world of music. And then here I am in their world, you know.
Yeah, because it's not like Katati's close or anything. Like, that's just so random that you would even be there. Katati's from Dublin, is fucking 2 hours, like, north. Right. Like, it's crazy.
Right,
yeah.
And I didn't really know what Exodus or who Exodus was at the time, you know, at all, you know. So, but it was just funny. I think back, it's like, man, I was such a different world of music for me, not understand what was going on in the other studio, to you know, doing what I do now, and you know, just going through that whole scene, you know, just weird the way it works.
One of the things that I heard on this podcast I was listening to you, which I'd never heard before, and I was surprised, but correct me if I'm wrong, but Legacy is already signed, but then Zetro leaves to join Exodus. You join Legacy, and the label's kind of, I don't know, they're maybe unsure about the new guy, and so they want you to do a demo. Or maybe they want you to audition for them or something, right?
A demo first. Like Johnny? It's a demo.
Okay.
Yeah, first, Zet left. They had a deal, and Zet decided to leave before the deal. And
crazy.
Yeah, I mean.
not, you know, he's joining Exodus, you know, but so.
Isn't that weird? Your first record deal, you got it, and now I'm going to leave it. It's like, what? You know, and it's just weird that way that worked. But yeah, I was, they had to deal with Johnny Z at Megaforce. Because of Maria and all that, you know, because that demo they did really got some attention across Europe and everything, and really
that demo was awesome.
Made their way over to Johnny and them on the East Coast, so Maria got them to do a deal, and then they left. So then it was kind of like, well, who's the new singer? And so they said, well, let's hear him. So of course I went and sang the exact same demo. I went and did it at some house in Berkeley next to the management's offices, and sent it back, and they said, okay, that sounds good, you know, I'm gonna come watch, do an audition. So they flew out to the Bay Area to watch rehearsals, and you know, of course that went odd, because the next morning during rehearsal, it was over at the practice pad in Oakland, I think it was, that was the night before Cliff had passed. So Johnny and Marcia show up for the audition in the morning around noon, and they were beat, wiped out, no sleep, been up all night.
Yeah.
And told us what happened. And we were just like, what? No way. And we're just all just floored. And, you know, here we are about to audition for our life, you know, and it was just kind of a weird audition because it was so somber. No words were said after the news. And
oh, wow.
We played our songs, and it was just this pretty simple, like, very good. We got a deal. And it was kind of just like that. And they left, they had to get going and do their thing. And, you know, so it was a strange signing and a strange event, but that was kind of one of those things that will always like date stamp, you know, where I was that day, you know, when it happened.
Yeah. So you basically joined a band that was signed already. I mean, like, that's pretty incredible. Like
luck.
Yeah.
And I'm still here.
Yeah.
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 Very fortunate. I mean, you know, and I think like anybody, when you start a band or join a band, you know, you have hopes that's what you're going to do to the end, you know, and been very fortunate and blessed. And I think really fortunate and blessed in 2005, I think, you know, after I beat cancer, because I really thought after cancer, I wasn't going to play music anymore. I was done. I mean, I looked in the mirror, was bald, just wasn't the same person. I didn't recognize the singer Testament looking at myself. So Mike, I was done. I wasn't going to play music. And just kind of weird from that point thinking when that having that benefit show and Alex coming back for the first time and Greg and Louie for first time, all of us to get back on a stage really did open a door kind of for the idea of possibly let's try something together. And I think during that benefit show, we were actually re-recording a record called, I can't remember, but we had to re-record
First Strike.
First Strike Still Deadly because yeah. Atlantic wouldn't let us remix the tracks. So we just re-recorded them and we figured it's going to be better anyhow. So at that time I said, hey, Alex, since you're in town, we want to come, we're tracking in Soundwave. You want to come down tomorrow and do some of the leads for the record, all the old songs? And he's like, sure. So that really kind of opened the door to Alex coming back and everybody. And then when 2005, we had the full-on reunion show because Andre from Dynamo called me up and said, hey, I got the original Anthrax committed to Dynamo next year. It'd be great if I can get the original Testament. What do you think? So well, that'd be awesome. You know, Anthrax, of course, took us the first time to Europe, first band we ever went tour with in Europe. Yeah, that'd be great. So I called up the guys and they were down to do it. And so it was just going to be one show. And the one show kind of turned into 10 and then carried on till here we are today. You know, yeah. Louis couldn't play because he has arthritis in his hands and we had to make a decision like, you know, it'd be unfortunate to go on tour and you have an issue with your hands and we have to like cancel shows. So we're going to have to get a new drummer and had to do that. And then Greg quit a few years later and, you know, but here we are today with Alex still in the group and contributing a lot. And
yeah,
and we're fortunate. I think since that 2005 date and Alex being in here, it's been kind of a rebirth for this band because, as you know, when you're in bands, you're kind of still in competition with people and want to do well. But I think what we've had and went through in the full circle, once having the reunion, it was more like setting us at ease almost. Like, you know what? I'm comfortable with what I am and what we do and who we are. And it is what it is. And it really made us write better records, I think, and not really thinking about what people want to hear or what they're going to expect. Or, you know, it's like, I'm writing this because I like writing this and enjoy this. And this is what I want to express.
Being creative. Yeah.
Yeah. And it really, I think, made the process better. I think we've been writing better records since then. And it's the process has been better and more fun, more enjoyable.
You go into the first album with Alex Perialis, right? Mm-hmm. For the Legacy.
Yeah.
Do you go to the upstate New York place? The
Ithaca, Prairie Sun.
Ithaca.
Pyramid Sound.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. That was wild in itself. I mean, we're five guys that really never left California up to that point, you know, and they're really ventured much in the snow, and here we are throwing
up. Did you guys do a handful of shows with you, like to kind of introduce you to the Bay Area fans? And
just a handful. I think I did Scottish Rite Temple with Suicidal and them, and
I did parties. That show with you. Yeah. I did that show with you. Yeah.
Yeah, with that.
Forbidden played.
Yeah. Yep, yep. And then we did just a couple parties and just a couple local shows, but not much really, you know. It kind of all just kind of steamrolled really once.
I totally forgot you were the singer in Legacy at that point. Like until you said that just now, because I've seen that flyer a bunch, but that's crazy. Yeah.
Yeah, that was one of my
crazy fucking
shows. Crazy.
That was an insane, like Suicidal came in and fucking like beat up everybody in the audience. It was insane.
It's crazy. And you know, and for me, you know, like again, I said, I come from a little bit of different background. The whole violent crowd, you know, LA bands coming up and the surfers and skaters and just it was pretty intense. And for me, it was like, holy shit, this is wild. But you know, it was like right up my alley because, you know, it was like people getting hurt, getting physical. And that's right. What I liked, you know? And it's yeah. Pretty awesome.
Yeah, that was my last show with Forbidden. And then I joined Violence right after that.
Wow.
So it's kind of a weird, you know, transition. So you go then to Alex Perry Alice, you go all the way back east, five guys, first time leaving California. And you're recording your debut album, which has got to be pretty fucking thrilling. I mean, you're signed after, which is awesome.
Yeah, I mean, it's when looking back, I mean, of course, I look back and wish you could do things different. That was our first record. We really didn't have much studio experience. We just put it all in everybody else's hands. But, you know, we did capture something at that moment. I don't think we probably could have captured again. But I probably would have, you know, watching the techniques we did then, recording guitars and drums, you know, I look at those records and go, man, I wish I could remix those and make those sound better. You know, I just really wish I could. But the first record, the masters were lost. They're gone. And Atlantic wouldn't let us do it. Yeah, we got from the New Order on. We somehow, Johnny Z. He had him in his closet. Swears he told me that, Chuck, I got a hold of you and told you if you want him. I said, Johnny, if you would have called me and said, hey, I got your masters. Do you want them? Do you really think I'd have said no?
Yeah, fuck
and
I do.
Throw them away. You really think I'd have said no? How could you have done that? So he tossed them. And I'm like, no, are you sure? So no. Let's call Pyramid. Are you sure there's not a copy up there? Nope. Alex, I gave them all to Johnny. He had all the safeties and everything. I'm like, man, jeez. So those are gone. So, but I went and actually have the New Order on up, and I actually took all the 2-inch tapes and all had them baked and put down to Pro Tools.
Oh, rad.
So I have that's all awesome. Those ready to remix if we
wow,
can. But Atlanta's
killer.
kind of being jerks about that. So I'm just going to sit on it and, you know, see what happens, you know.
Yeah. What's the first tour you do with from that record?
First tour was, let me think. I don't know if it was, I think it was, I can't remember if it was America or Europe, but I remember Europe was with the Anthrax, the first tour.
Yeah.
Of course, awesome. You know, we're with Megaforce, so everything we're going to do is with Megaforce.
Oh, right. Anthrax is Megaforce, yeah.
Johnny Z's, you know, so we go to Europe with Megaforce. We come back to America, go out with Overkill. Another Johnny Megaforce band.
Right,
you know,
right.
Nuclear Assault. After that, you know, all the Megaforce
which
stuff.
Which is smart. You know, it's fucking smart. Like, and you know, not to mention that all those bands are doing. Like, Anthrax is fucking huge at that point. Probably this is 87. So this is Among the Living that you're doing.
87 Among the Living. Yeah.
Wow, that's fucking. I mean, this is when Anthrax is, you know, fucking crushing,
just killing it. Yeah, it was a great tour to be on. Great exposure. You know. And you know, really riding their wings because Johnny Z, of course, is pushing them and has to push us. So it was a good place to be. You know, I think I don't know. I mean, I think Testament might not be where they're at if we didn't find Megaforce. You know, if we had found some other label, maybe didn't know what to do with you or didn't have them at success, who knows what would have happened, you know? So I owe a lot to Maria because Maria really pushed us to Johnny, you know, forced us on him. Really. Yeah.
And those strategic alignments definitely helped, you know, because Anthrax was fucking hot. I mean, that was huge. That was a platinum record for Anthrax, you know, like.
Yeah, then right after that, shortly right into the next record, it was with Megadeth, you know, and, you know, of course, we got in there through Johnny and his connections. you know, but those were those years. You got to remember those years we did 5 records in 5 years and toured
yes.
between them. There was no breaks. It was go on the road, tour, hurry up, write that, record it, and let's get back out there, you know.
Are you and still living with your parents like through this
we
time?
All were. We all lived on the couch. We all, I think, probably only made like $600 a month or something, and not or making crap, you know. You know, but it was coming along quick because there was no time at home. And at that time, we were selling records. Those were the days when people were actually selling records, you know.
Yeah.
You know, right up through those first 4 records were moving well. And I think us and a lot of the Bay Area bands at that moment were really put in a position to take that next step to where like Anthrax, Metallica, Megadeth, you know, gold and platinum artists were. There was a next wave that was right there and loaded up, ready to go. And then kind of like, you know, kind of changed when that, you know, whole Seattle thing went down, you know, once.
Who's managing you guys at this point? Like
Elliot Kahn and Jeff Saltzman.
Oh, right. Kahn man. That's right.
Kahn man.
Was Alexis involved somewhere in there?
Alexis was up through the Legacy. He was, okay. He was Legacy's management up through the first record. And he was actually our manager, and Elliot was the attorney as we got signed. And okay. then as we started touring, Alexis kind of got axed out a little bit. And then
gotcha.
And then Elliot and Jeff kind of took over.
And then, right. Yeah. So. New Order was, I mean, I think for like, at least for me, you know, and this is my young thrasher mind who is kind of, you know, I'm not even signed. I'm just watching you guys get bigger. But, you know, we had already heard all the songs on most of the songs on the Legacy already prior with Zet, you know, record was right. Awesome. You know, we watched you guys. It was killer. When New Order dropped though, we were just like, oh shit. Like this is fucking like you guys, you know, leveled up and went to someplace. I don't know if a lot of people expected you to go. We all thought everybody had high hopes for you. Testament was definitely like everybody knew you guys were on the rise. But New Order, like I remember hearing New Order for the first time and just being fucking blown away. Like just blown away.
Yeah, I mean, that was my first record where I got to contribute a lot in every song and actually put my kind of stamp on my vocal approach to that style. And, you know, I think a lot of those songs, we're on tour with Anthrax in Europe and we're in the back of the bus. And I remember Alex and Eric having acoustic guitars and that's how we wrote that record. You know, they're playing into the pit on acoustic and we're like, okay, you know, we're singing out words and humming out words. We're young and had nothing to do and just sitting around the back of the bus drinking and writing because we knew we didn't know any better. We didn't know how to do it. Nobody told us. We just figured, okay, there's another tour. We got to make another record. Okay, let's just start writing songs, you know? And we really didn't know because I didn't know what that record would be until we got home and played it electric because we didn't really play it on sound check or anything. It was only acoustic and the riffs and a bunch of scribbled words until we got home. And once we played electric, we went, holy shit, you know, that's got way more impact, you know, than the acoustic because like the New Order riff, da-da-da. That's not very impactful on an acoustic, you know. You know, right. But when all of a sudden when I heard it on the left, like, holy shit, that's monstrous. Fuck.
Right.
Like, that's way heavier than I don't remember the acoustic being like that, but that's how we scratched out the acoustic. And it's like it really took a whole new life electrically, but we were like, wow, that was it blew us away. It blew me away that Eric and Alex. It just told me who they were, what kind of writers they were at that moment, because they were so young, you know, but they just had these big ideas and these, you know, bigger than what they were, I guess, at the time, because they were just kids, you know. But that record really did make a statement for us, and it was really my first step, like, okay, here we are. Now we're Testament. The other record was Legacy turning into Testament, fulfilling those songs that they've practiced for the last, you know, 3 or 4
all years. Were all the lyrics already written for Legacy, or did you have some input in that?
I wrote one song, Do or Die was the only song that wasn't written that I got to contribute at the end.
Okay.
Once we got close to the studio time. And that was it. So I was kind of excited.
This is like a clean slate. Yeah, this is like everything's fresh. Everything's
well, because the first record I had that one song, and that was like, all right, my first recording, this is me. I wrote this. I contributed, and that kind of got me excited to go into the next thing. What can I do? Contribute to this, but still learn because they're still teaching me. I don't know at all this style yet. You know, still learning as I'm going. And it just that record came on once we got home there, because we were at home living at mom's. We didn't want to be at home, so we spent a lot of time at the studio, and we were young kids, and I think I was just about enough to be able to buy beer, so I'd buy and contribute and get all the rest of the guys drunk. They weren't old to drink yet, so we were drinking illegally down there, and that was the thing to do. Let's get out of the house and go drink at the studio and smoke weed and just jam, and that's all we did, you know. And
yeah.
So once we got home from touring, that's all we wanted to get back to. Let's get back to the rehearsal room, set back up, and get back into drinking more beer and doing what we do. And let's play those songs we wrote. And it really came together pretty quick, you know, on that song. And, you know, and there were songs that were towards the end, I think like Trial by Fire and songs like that were a little more collaborative, thought out, and weren't so much on the spot like those other ones. That was... you know, you can tell that was a little more step into the practice what you preach era, where they're a little more commercialized or accessible. I don't know what word you want to use for it, but they were starting to step away from the thrashier thrash that the guys had really started out doing.
Mm-hmm. Are you single at this point?
I had a girlfriend, but I just on practice, me and Tiffany got together.
Yeah, but during like New Order and the first album, you're like, you got a girlfriend, but I had a girlfriend. Not married. You're not married.
Dog will hunt.
This is the Chuck Billy. These are these slutty Chuck Billy years.
Yeah, dog will hunt. Yeah. Yes.
I'm so stealing that. That's so good. That's really good. Dog will hunt.
Yeah, so you know, it was like that, you know. I mean, and you know,
you guys were getting a lot. Like, I got to say, of all the thrash bands, like you guys drew a lot of girls. Like, girls love Testament, you know. Like, I don't know necessarily what the difference was, but you guys, if I wanted to get laid, I was going to the Testament show. I was going to get way more pussy at the Testament show than I was ever going to get at, you know, something else sometimes.
Yeah, I don't know what that is about that, but you know, we sure didn't mind it because, of course, you know, as we started out, it was all sausage fest at all the shows, and
yes. Yeah,
girls coming was like right on. Wow, I can meet a girl and maybe have a girlfriend that likes the same music I like at one of these shows, you know. So that was, you know, mm-hmm. great that opened up, you know, doors for women to enjoy this style of music. But yeah, we're single all through that time, and just. You know, when you joined the band, it really was sex, drugs, rock and roll. That's what you thought, man. And that's when you get out on the road, that's what it was. Sex, drugs, rock and roll. trying to live it and do what you hear and read about and destroy rooms and party all night and get chicks walking on doing the bus thing. And, you know, you try to do it all. And I think we did, you know.
That's awesome. That is awesome.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
No, I just said it's funny you live through that, and then you know, I guess as years evolve and you grow up and start having your family, and then you start realizing, because you think back, it's like, you know, that's our home, and we just let people like ravage and run wild through our home, and our that's our life.
In your tour bus, yeah,
in our bus, and things are much different today, where you're like, nobody's coming on here because, you know,
yeah.
We don't trust anybody. We don't know, you know, that are coming on here. It's off limits. Sure.
Yeah. Well, after you've had your 300th iPod stolen, you're like, okay, enough of this shit. You know, like,
right. Exactly. I mean, that's just it. Or the money, or the merch money, you know, it's just stupid shit.
Right.
You know?
Right. Right. I can't remember exactly what the timeline was, but Violence goes out with Testament on the New Order tour. I don't know if this is your first tour that you're doing for that record or if it's into the cycle. I believe it was
towards the end of the cycle, because I think at the beginning we did like some mega stuff, Death in Europe and stuff. We came back and it was kind of like our first, like, we're going to get to do a headline tour. You know, that's kind of, was kind of our exposed. All right.
Is that your first headline tour? Okay.
And it was, but thinking back, it's like, wow, we only had our second record ready to go. And, you know, we kind of were coming up quick, I guess, you know?
I mean, dude, that was a big fucking tour. Like, I don't know if any of the Violence guys realized how big of a tour it was, but it was, I mean, there was fucking sun. I mean, we were playing the Vic in Chicago. We were playing like fucking rodeos in fucking Florida or Texas. And it was like 3,000 people. We were like, what the fuck? Like, it was crazy. Like,
yeah, they had the great rooms, like the Network and all those great rooms we used to play and stuff. And,
oh my God, that Baltimore Network show.
Phil's night that night.
That was a fucking one of the funnest. My God, what a fucking, it was so much fun.
Yeah.
First of all, George from Cannibal Corpse was at that show as a fan in the front row. He like talk every time I hang out with him, he fucking brings that up. He's like, oh my God, that show was so fucking good. You know, everybody who's loving it. But after the show, I don't really remember. The show was great. I just remember going up to the little after party upstairs bar. And it was one of the memories I have of all the bands and all the crew, you guys, us all just getting fucking shit faced. and there's this super hot,
bartender.
The super hot bartender Nick Perry, who I guess is fucking David Lee Roth or something. That's what she's telling us. Right. She's like fucking David Lee Roth. And Phil falls in love with her. He's like, Terry's playing like Careless Whisper like 17 times in a row. And it's like, whoa, dude. Like fucking. My final memory of the night is of you dragging Phil from the top stair by his feet and just watching his head go kapunk, 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 all the way down the staircase.
And then out the parking lot
and dragging him through mud.
Putting him to bed.
Too fucking funny, man.
That was for his own good.
It was. You were helping him out.
Yeah, we were.
I mean, I tell you what, that tour was fucking phenomenal. I mean, there's so many crazy things. I remember there was like Sanctuary was on for a lot of it. I think MOD came on for a couple of shows. And, you know, like wild shit.
Yeah, I mean, think of it now. I mean, that whole scene around the country and world everywhere, you know, and you know, you look at it now and go, and all these people everywhere, you know,
killing, just
the movement. There was something about the Bay Area too, just we built such a reputation in the Bay Area, all this Bay Area bands. And I think, you know, I think we were all very fortunate that we all had some great success, but we all didn't copy or sound like each other. Everybody had their own identity, but it all represented the Bay Area. And it's really funny that people identify that. They know it's a Bay Area, but we all have
for sure
came up with our own identities.
Yeah, absolutely. I remember on that tour, by the end of that tour, we were all starting to get a little cocky, like, we're the ones kind of helping draw all these people here. Like, that's what we were saying amongst ourselves. And then we left your tour and jumped onto the Voivod tour and the cold, hard reality of, oh no, that was actually just Testament drawing all those people. Because nobody gives a shit about us on this tour. It was a big eye-opening experience. And it was an eye-opening experience just going like, wow, man, like Testament really is like fucking crushing it. Like, this is, it's fucking, it's awesome, you know, like it's amazing.
Well, it was great to have that machine like Johnny behind you. And I think after our second record, we really went from Megaforce, from the legacy, from the New Order, starting on Atlantic Records. So I think from Atlantic Records,
oh really,
Yeah, because Johnny
Water was on Atlantic or through Atlantic or something.
Yeah, it's through Atlantic because Johnny at that point made a deal with Atlantic, giving up some of the Megaforce artists to go over to Atlantic, and we were one of the artists.
Gotcha.
So we went over to New Order through Atlantic, and then everything after that was straight Atlantic. So I think once we started working with Atlantic and we were working hard, putting our records always on tour, all of a sudden we had this giant machine, bigger than Megaforce's machine, as far as marketing and press and radio, and everything kind of came quick and started growing. But unfortunately, that Atlantic machine was thinking commercial, where I think they kind of stumbled, it threw a wrench in us a little bit, because they were always like, where's the single? Where's the video, the ballad? You know, but that's who we were kind of being, you needed to do, and we're going to sell a million records, we're all going to be millionaires, and, you know, this is what we have to do. And I think we were kind of maybe blinded by that a little bit. And looking back now, I think that's kind of screwed us a little bit in our positioning, because, you know, at a certain point when I hear music sometimes, it's they put us back as that type of band where it shows the ballads and all the commercial songs. And it's like, well, that's not the representation of who Testament is and was, and, you know, and right. So that's what kind of gets me down a little bit. That machine was great to have, but it really, as far as creativity wise, being like that, it messed us up a little bit, I think, you know, once that practice point. You know, and I think that's when we started
practice partying. Practice was no more on Megaforce. It was just directly to Atlantic.
Atlantic, yeah. And then Souls of Black throughout the rest of it, six records through Atlantic. And I think
there was a big push behind Practice, though. I mean, I remember, I went to a Foundations and it was like just Testament. I mean, you couldn't fucking turn around without seeing the Testament Practice video.
It's huge. And those were the days when the labels would build displays and stores, and you would have the whole window space and all the things. And that's when you had a big machine there, had that capability to do that kind of stuff and push you and get you and, you know, certain things. And you know, I think I don't know, maybe Alex started getting creatively different. He, you know, started wanting to learn more about jazz because he was young, got into the band. He never really had a teenage years. He was 15 through, you know, 18, 19, and was on tour the whole time, you know? So I think he wanted to grow up, and things started changing and our taste started changing and when we started working. And that's, I think we started growing apart, really. And, you know, towards those years of Testament, it really couldn't save it and go back and put it back to where it was. You know, we kind of had to just let it take its course and then happen, let it fall where it's fallen. When Alex and everybody left, and that's when Merrick really kind of looked at each other and said, you know what? It's time to be heavy again and get back to what we want to do and not compromise with ourselves and do it. And that's what really put us on the course where we got back, found ourselves again, you know?
What was the name of your, I'm totally flashing back to touring with you. What was the name of you kind of had like a glammy sound guy. I'm trying to like remember.
David, he
was
Pig.
Like a real David Pig. That's it. Yeah, that's right.
David Pig and Mark Workman. They were the team out there, you know.
That was the team on that tour.
That was
what
the team.
A fucking team. Holy moly.
And then right after David left, Rick Desing came in and was Desing and Workman. You know? No, Desing came in doing monitors. It was Pig, Desing, and Workman.
Okay. Jesus Christ.
What a team.
As Mark Workman would say, Jesus God.
Yeah.
But fucking some of the best, I mean, the best guy in the fucking, you know, maybe the world, you know, like,
yeah,
easily my favorite light guy, the just incredible, like, insane, intuitive.
Yeah, there's no one like him. His timing for people's band's music is just like no other lighting people I've ever seen, as far as timing and just knowing the material very well. And, yeah,
and you know, fucking just one of the biggest characters in rock and roll. I mean, fucking a madman in a lot of ways.
He is, and you know, he's lived it, the sex, drug, rock and roll, and got out of the business just in time, you know, to move on with his life. And you know, Mark, you know, he could be down in the dumps over little thing. And
yes,
you know, you don't like him like that. You like seeing him in a happy Mark. And so when he's not around the music business, he's happy Mark. And when I visit him now, I've went and seen him, you know, he runs Cliffside Malibu down in Southern California Rehab Center. And he's been sober now since he left the tour. You know, he tried to come back as a being sober on tour, and it just really didn't work. So once he got back, started running the Sober Living House there.
Wow, good for him, man.
He's been doing great ever since. He's been amazing, and he's gotten healthy, lost a bunch of weight. He's slim and trim. You wouldn't even recognize him now.
Holy shit.
Yeah,
I got to reach out to him. It's been a while since I talked to him.
You should, but he's the same old character, same humor, same everything.
He's
he's
amazing. I love him. He's done so many shitty things, and I still love him. He's just fucking such a character.
Yeah, if you could reach out to him, because he enjoys hearing people in the past. Is, you know, I know once he got off the tour, just, you know, found the struggle of being out there and trying to control, you know, your habits and stuff, and.
Yeah.
And you know, I'm so glad that he found it, because, you know, I've been good friends with him for so long and seen the ups and downs with him, and to see him now on a solid path and, you know, relationship, and he's got his head on straight, and he's
awesome.
You know, because it for a time I thought, man, I don't want to lose Mark, you know, the next 10 years, you know, just like everybody else, you know, that can't get things under control. He finally got under control.
It's hard to get, I mean, like, to stay sober on the road, anybody, you know, I think, like, I look at somebody like Randy, who used to be fucking, you know, when we first started touring with Randy, my God, like, it was just beers from 8 o'clock in the morning till, you know, four in the, it was it never stopped. And like, you know, to still see him be able to go out and be on the road and stay sober, it's one of the hardest things I think that anybody can do. It's so fucking hard because there's just so much temptation. There's so much, you know, there's fucking as much alcohol as you want in the backstage at any time. You know, like,
it's tough
to be able to say.
I've quit drinking now, coming up on 5 years. And
awesome.
Yeah, 5 years. But, you know, I still, you know, have those times. Like, my favorite thing was when I was flying somewhere. I'd love to have that beer before I got on a plane and crash out going to Europe or something. It was always those little things that still to this day I'll get there and go, man, that beer just sounds good right now, and get on that plane and sleep. But, you know, I think I found and are comfortable now, and I've got over the hump to where I just don't need it anymore. You know, now I find myself, because at first I said, you know, especially with Tiffany, we'd go out and like, oh, I don't want to go out to party and not drink. I'm not going to have fun. And she always used to say, you know what? You can have fun at a party not drinking. And I never got it. And then, you know, once I stopped drinking and started not depending on it or any of that, you know, it's like, you know what, she's right. I can actually go out and have fun at a party and not have to be drunk or drinking. And
yeah,
it's true. So now I look back, and now it's in my rear view mirror now.
Yeah. Good for you. Congrats, man. That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's huge. 5 years is a long time.
Yeah.
It's a lot longer than people think.
Well, I mean, I'll say you know, I'll have a beer and put it this way, you know, it's far like Ted from Death Angel. He doesn't drink either, but like we did the tour in Europe, like the end of the tour, I know you have your celebration beer. I guess what? I'm going to have one with you, you know, something like that, you know, things like that.
Yeah.
Just, but you know, I haven't been drunk in 5 years, you know?
Yeah. Take me back to, so after practice, which is big, you guys get, you know, at least my recollection of stuff was that you got the Judas Priest tour with Megadeth. And then it was like, suddenly, like there was this pressure to write Souls of Black, like maybe unexpectedly.
Well, we got the tour. We're in tour. Let's see. We're in tour. We did Megadeth and stuff, and we're in tour. We know we got the Priest tour, but they said, you have to have a new record. So we're like, oh shit, okay. Well,
Priest
no problem.
Said that? Priest said that? Or, oh wow, okay, gotcha.
So we're like, okay, well, we can do that. So we went home and wrote and recorded the record in 6 weeks. And went in, got it done, and recorded. Said, okay, we got one. We got it. And we had a new record, had the big machine ready to push it and do what they needed to do with it. And we got the tour and off we went. You know, we met the deadline.
Wow. I mean, that's a lot of pressure for one to write a fucking record in 6 weeks. It's insane. Tour. Like,
but it was Priest. It was like, come right. on, we're gonna tour Judas Priest. Are you serious? And believe me, when I was a guitar player, I cut school like my senior year just to play Priest. I'd go play, you know, those records. I knew Priest very well on guitar, so those were my heroes. So when I had the opportunity to go out with Priest, I'm
yeah, this is dream come true, right?
Go, guys. Yes, we're not gonna not do this tour because we don't have a record. Come on. So we did it, you know, and made it happen, you know.
And this is when Priest is still fucking massive at this point. This is arena tour. This is arenas in the United States.
What's that? Huge. Painkiller, right? 92 or what is it? Or yes. 91, 92, yeah.
Big comeback record.
Yeah.
Megadeth is on fifth album, right?
And we just came from the Megadeth tour in Europe, straight to fly into Canada to start the Judas Priest tour, and we were rolling, starting to bring in some money. So for the Priest tour, we decided we're going to spend some money on production. We bought a big fancy Volker rack drum set. We bought two new scrims, full on backline, you know, the whole deal, nice looking show. And we get to the first show and Dave Mustaine sees us have it up and he says, we can't use it. And
what?
We had a little problem. First week of the tour.
We had a problem.
That
did the old Chuck sudden, Billy come out? Did Chuck Billy come out?
I did come out. I was starting to come out. But I was pissed because we had just spent all this money. And those were the days where they were hand-painted backdrops. These backdrops were 15, 20 grand. They weren't cheap then.
Right.
So we're like, we're coming out to represent Priest Tour in arenas, man. We're coming out.
And who is the support act to say, you know, like if the headliner is cool with it. Like,
that's what I thought. But Dave threw his weight around and said, you know, we can't use all of our new stuff. So for the first week, we're like tail between the legs playing and all the guys in our band are saying, Chuck, you know, Robb, you know, you seem to be friends with Robb. Go in there and tell him. You know, he's telling you guys, if you guys need anything, just ask. Go in there. And I had it. And I said, you know what? I'm gonna. So I went in there. It's like, I don't know, 3-4 days into the tour. I go in the dressing room. I say, hey, Robb, you know, you got a minute? You know, I need to talk to you. And I go, I don't know, you know, who to talk to, but I'm going to come to you. And if it's your guys' decision, hey, I'm down with it, but I thought I would just bring it up. But, you know, we bought all this stuff for this tour, you know, to put on a nice show. And the Megadeth guy says we can't play it because they said, you know, you guys wouldn't let us use it. It's like, what? Who said that? And nonsense. Right then he got up, went and got his tour manager, said, get in here. He says, do you know anything about this? Them not letting Testament use their gear? I said, he says, no. And I said, he goes, you make sure tonight they get the damn gear and they get their gear up there tonight. So that's we awesome. Had the full-blown show, and who comes side stage to watch the show? Here comes Mr. Mustaine. Mustaine standing there, just pissed off, just had that look at us.
Is he squinting his eyes?
I'm looking over, just like, oh yeah, Dave. Oh yeah, we're, you know, putting it on, throwing it down, you know, and that's how that tour started, you know. But here we are, we had a new record, new promotion, we're ready to go, new big show, we're like, you know, this is like our first step into an arena. Oh man, maybe we're making it. We're doing it, you know. And to get shut down the first time, we weren't having it. And it was great to be at guys like Priest. They were just always came in the dressing room every day, said, hey, how are you guys doing? You guys good? You guys need anything? And, you know, we were just too shy to ask. And you know, and we did find out that they really were who they were. They stepped up, made it happen, and we had full show the rest of the tour, man, and sound at that point too.
Wow. I mean, that's dude, like, you know, that to the average listener, they're probably just like, yeah, so what? That didn't happen. Like, you got, you know, there was many times when a band would get 25% lights, 25% sound, you know, the 75% would be saved for the headliner.
No, they didn't care because they are confident what they did, and and wanted everybody to have a good show. I had wanted the crowd to leave seeing a kick-ass show, and that's what it was. And you know, that was our first taste to, you know, big arena stuff, you know, and learned a lot watching them and the crews and how they work.
Is this your first time? Is that your first time meeting the Priest guys?
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is the first, I mean, how, what an honor this must have, you know, you just must have been so fucking over the moon.
Well, it was an honor. Plus we, and they seemed to know a lot about us, and they were just so friendly and so just whatever you guys, whatever you boys need, you know, just let us know.
Mm-hmm.
And it really, but you felt as kids, like, you know, I'm not in your league. You know, I can't ask you for that. I'm too afraid to come hang out with you. Or, you know, it's just, it was like, that's the way it was, you know?
Yeah. I remember listening to Painkiller thinking, oh shit, like they're kind of doing the Testament thing. You know, like he started doing the arpeggios, and like Glenn Tipton in particular really started bringing in that, like, Alex Skolnick. I was like, oh, whoa. Like, I thought it was cool. Like, well, holy shit.
You know, it's funny, Rob Halford on that tour, because he is hearing me do, I wasn't really doing full on death stuff, but I was doing some low things. He started doing it during that tour. And I'm like, oh, Rob, what's going on? I'm trying to do a little, you know, I guess, you know, he thinks, oh, the crowd loves this kind of voice, you know? And
right.
He was trying to do a little death style and some stuff, you know? And,
that's awesome. It's awesome that you can influence your, you know, influence your inspiration like that.
Yeah.
I'm kind of, you're frozen on me. I don't know if you're hearing everything I'm saying.
Yeah, I hear you.
Okay, cool. I mean, that's amazing. I caught that show at the Oakland Arena. It was fucking, you guys crushed it. Like, it was fucking amazing. Like, everybody was just like, oh my God, like fucking.
Yeah. We were so ready for that show because, of course, it's home. And, of course, you want to, you know, do the show of your life for your home crowd. And that honestly was the first and last show my mom ever came and seen me. First time she ever seen me perform was at that Oakland show. And my mom and dad were there. And so that was a moment, a night for me to remember. I was very proud because, you know, here I was doing my thing.
Right.
And for the years, her always telling me, don't be a singer, go to school, get a good job, you know, because my mom didn't want me to be a singer because, you know, she was a singer growing up. And she lost her mom and some of her family in a car wreck. She was singing at a fair, and the family was going to see her perform, and they got a car wreck and died. And it really bummed her out, so she decided she's not going to sing anymore. And you know, and that was her, like, don't be a singer, Chuck. Don't sing. Just go to school, get a job. You know, she really didn't want me to be a singer. But that night was the night she got me to shine. And I was so ready to, like, show her what she was so against me doing. And it was the first and only time she got to see me perform. And so that night was very special. And we tore it down pretty good that night.
Oh, you fucking... I mean, it was fucking circle pits from like the fucking like second one, you know. It was crazy. Like, it was like, holy shit. It was the first time I'd ever seen a circle pit for Judas Priest. And I was like, that's because that Testament crowd's here. You know, like, there wouldn't be a circle pit without that, you know, without the Bay Area rapping like that.
Not at all.
I mean, that must have been fucking, that whole, I can't even imagine how awesome that tour must have been.
It was awesome. I stood next to the guy who fed the teleprompter every night to Rob. I sat there and watched the show every night. And sometimes the monitor guy would give me Rob's mix in the headphones I'd put on and have Rob's mix.
Oh, nice.
And listen to him. And I'd be like, oh my God, this is so amazing. So my future down the road, I always fought in-ears. I never liked them. And once I converted to in-ears, I'm like, man, I sure wish I could get that Halford mix. That was just like amazing, like record quality. You know, it's like you're in the studio. It's just like,
oh shit. Yeah. What did he have? Did he have everybody in the mix?
Yeah, or just mostly him? Everybody in the mix, but he was loud, but the effects on him were just perfect. You know, like in a studio, just delay stops perfectly. The timing just
crisp. That's killer.
It's just, you don't have to force and push and work too hard, you know, because your voice is right there, you know. It was awesome.
Are you guys hanging out a lot on that tour? Do you guys is the bands hanging out like near the end, like as a band?
We hung out a lot because they were always at the venues early. They didn't just show up at Showtime soundcheck and come. They were there early doing sound checks, hanging out, always in the dress room, in the hallways, hanging out. Like I said, they'd always pop in, you know. Robb was always kind of to himself, but he was always friendly. But KK and Glenn Tipton were always the real friendly guys coming in, saying hello. And of course, Scott Travis, he was always hanging out and, you know, burn a little bit of whatever.
Do you ever get hammered with Judas Priest?
I don't remember ever getting drunk, but I know there was a couple nights where they sent us a fine bottle of whiskey and stuff. I'm like, oh, that's how you do it. Like, can you tell management, can you buy them some nice champagne or something? You know, they bought us some wine, and what do we do? You know, how do we respond to that? You know, so, you know, we sent them, we knew that Glenn and some of them like drinking nice red wines. So we'd find some really good red wines and we'd find out what they liked and we'd try to get it to them and, you know, find out their birthdays and get a cake or have some nice alcohol. Or Robb had a birthday. I bought him a really nice cowboy hat from Texas, and we all had it signed, you know, and enjoyed that. And just, you know, really cool. So they were really around a lot, really. They were probably one of the most friendly bands I've ever toured with that were like my heroes like that, that were, you know, just really, really down to earth, like always just like helping him, like, just let me know, man. Just let me know if you need something. Don't be too shy. Just, you know, if anything, just ask us.
Yeah. You know? That's awesome. That's fucking rad. Somewhere around here, you guys do the ritual, and I'm not sure if my timing is off on this, what record is still on, but Slayer drops Season of the Abyss and you guys are support to Slayer. Is the ritual out at that point? I'm gonna say it's January.
I can't remember okay. That, but I, you know, that whole ritual tour didn't.
Is that Clash of the Titans time somewhere around
We did the Clash of the Titans was Souls of Blackish.
Oh, area. Still on Souls of Black. Okay.
Yeah, right through the Souls of Black. The ritual is when the label Atlantic was really pushing towards singles and radio hits, and metal was actually being played during drive time, traffic time around that time. So obviously that's, you know, we want to sell records or trying to be in the radio or whatever. And I think it really, the band was a different band because the songs weren't thrash. They're really melodic, over melodic from what we were starting as. And I think at that point, I think Alex might have been, I'm not sure if he was doing this, I forgot what he was doing at that time, but Eric had wrote a lot of that record and the riffs already. And when Alex came back, I don't know if it was the Transparent Orchestra or what he was doing, but he came back, and when he came in, heard all the songs, he tamed them down a bit. They were too fast and thrashy. They slow them down, get them a little more groovy. And I think it took a little more life out of it. He might have disagreed with me, but that's the way I saw it, is that it kind of lost something on that record. And I think that's when we all just kind of were kind of growing apart anyhow. Alex was into experiencing more jazz and doing his jazz, and it was really had a bad sour taste for metal. He really didn't, I don't know what it was. I really don't know. You might want to ask. I never really talked to him, but from my perspective, I think because from 15 years old to where he was leaving the band, he learned that crowd and that crowd in performing and I don't know. I want to say maybe he was a little more sophisticated coming from parents who are law professors and psychologists, and they wanted him to be a professor and doctor, you know. I don't know. I think he had something to prove to himself, his parents, that he can accomplish more than what we were doing playing metal. And
but the ritual is before the Slayer Seasons in the Abyss tour or after?
I can't remember, because I know Alex's last tour, it had to be right around there, because it had to be at the beginning, because Alex's last tour was with Heaven and Hell. Black Sabbath was his final tour with us. So Slayer must have been before that. Okay. On the ritual.
I mean, that must have been a pretty fucking big tour for you guys. That was
it was rad. Big. It was huge, you know, but we knew because things were changing. You know, we felt that the band was changing, but it's funny, man. It's because we thought we should be getting harder and heavier and we're losing something. But fuck, man, that Ritual record sold more records than any of the other ones. And it was, I don't know what it was. I don't know if it was just the time or what.
I remember the ballad was pretty kind of all over MTV. Like it was
big. But still that didn't represent us, but still it's that record was, it was almost going gold. And we're like, holy shit, you know, wow. At that time. And, but we felt it wasn't us. It was the weirdest thing. And we wanted to be heavier, but we felt like if you're going heavier, are we going to lose the fans that are buying all these records? You know? But we probably wouldn't have had that aggressive stance if, like, you know, the whole grunge and the climate change of music at that time, because like I said, radio was happening for metal bands. And overnight, you know, I'd say there was almost 200 stations across the country playing metal, drive time, traffic.
Oh, yeah. I mean, there used to be like Slayer was getting played on like, you know, K-Rock or, you know, K-Rock. There was that big station with, like drive it was crazy. Times, like,
you know, and that vanished like literally overnight down to like 40 something stations. Literally when that whole Seattle thing went down and, you know, to where we found ourselves, okay, well, we don't have that now anymore. So now we got to, and we're done with Atlantic. We don't have the big machine now. So now we're pissed off. And now it's the band's breaking up.
Atlantic. Gotcha. Okay. Gotcha.
That's the last, Alex left after the Ritual. We had the Low record left as our final one. Johnny Tempesta joined the band. James Murphy got into the band and we're on the final record.
Greggy's still in the band.
But the music climate was changing and we were like, well, we don't have radio. We don't have MTV's not doing shit. Fuck, we're pissed off. We don't have a record contract. We don't got a record deal coming here soon. So we knew
what we were right. 94?
The Low record came out in 95, I think. Yeah, 95 or something like that. So we did that record, I guess, just a little bit more pissed off and angry. And at that point, I did that Dog Face Gods where I sang the first song like a full-on death metal all the way through. And a lot of new fans said, yeah, man, I like that. Do that. And then a lot of the older fans that liked that Ritual said, that, no, you're ruining your voice. And I was kind of like on a bubble. Like, I didn't know what to do. I mean, I don't know. I mean, they're selling records in this department, but I like doing this, and I feel I should be doing this, being a little harder. And, you know, in the end, I think we made the right decision because it led right into that Demonic record, which really went aggressive and did something for us, meeting Gene Hoagland.
I mean,
Hoagland,
those first two opening tracks are like almost death metal. You know, like you can tell totally. the music is testament, but it's like, I was like, holy shit. Like I didn't even know you had that in there. It was very cool to hear, you know, like.
Well, me neither, but because I was so influenced by the label pushing me to be melodic and stuff and carry melodies where now I'm like, all right, I could do that. I can sing like that. So let me try to do that all the whole song, you know, and I kind of started going into trying it that way. And like I said, I think I lost some fans, but gained some new ones because they didn't like me. They didn't want me to do that and like me to do that. And when I did the tour of that record after the Low Demonic, which Demonic was a full-on death metal record, all the whole song I sang very heavily, but I was, I don't know, depressed. The music industry's changing, you know, maybe partying a little too hard at that time. And that record came out what it was, but, you know, I think we found Gene Hoagland and I think really made a statement to me that, okay, maybe this isn't the way I should be going and doing, and this isn't the voice. And especially after going on the road, I think I damaged myself singing because it really took a toll on my throat after a whole
singing that low,
all the time and death. I really got really hoarse. So I really had to take some time off and I decided, okay, maybe I shouldn't do that. So that's when I kind of didn't know. And we fortunately got the next record, that Gathering record, Lombardo came aboard. And that's really what opened up Eric and changed everything again, because Lombardo inspired Eric, where Eric always, the guitar player, teaching the drummer what to play. where this time around the drummer was ready to play, just like, no, don't tell me, just play and I'll let me go. And that's the way
super creative, like super creative
way it got down, because Dave was used to doing that stuff, you know, just like with his Mr. Bungle or Pat and stuff he was doing. It's jamming, free-for-all kind of jamming. So that inspired Eric. He didn't have to think about that part of it. He just had to be write the music and think about the guitar riffs. So that record came out way better, and it really set the pace. Like, this is who Testament is. This is what Testament needs to be. As far as me singing, I really came back to trying to be melodic, but the old classic style a little, blending both.
Yes.
You know, no ballads, you know, just be a little more heavy. And then Eric introduced a little more of the stuff that he was doing with Dragon Lord. He started getting a little more blast beats into the music, and that we had never really did that. So that was another aspect that kind of opened up our world a little bit, you know?
Yeah. I always thought it was cool that you guys clearly had, you know, even throughout everything, you clearly had your ear to the street with underground metal still, you know, like you started bringing in elements of death metal, started bringing in elements of black metal, you know, like things that, you know, weren't there at the beginning, but you brought them in and continued to, like, you know, put them through the Testament, you know, filter or whatever. But
well, once we got off that big Atlantic machine, that's what freed us. I really do believe that, because we wanted to write heavy, and anything we wrote heavy, they'd go, they didn't get it, you know? And so there was a freedom about having the freedom to be heavier, write heavy and do what we want. And that felt really good. And that's what, you know, changed everything about what we do and how we carried ourselves, I guess, at that point on going forward.
Where is Greggy still in the band through the gathering? Is Greggy leave at this point?
At the gathering, Greg had just left at that point, right before the gathering. And Steve DiGiorgio came into the picture. We were on tour. Let's see, how'd that work? We were having some problems with Greg, and how Greg ended up leaving the band.
I remember seeing him around that time. He was really strung out on speed, and
it was really weird with Greg, and I'm sure I'll get some flack, and he'll write it. You know, he has his quiet moments, and we have our disagreements of way things happened in the band and went down, and the way things it panned out. We'll agree to disagree. But it just, once he left and decided he wasn't going to come back, I had actually been doing jamming a little bit on the side with DiGiorgio and John Allen from Sadus out in Antioch.
Oh, okay.
And we were going to do a little side project.
That's right. You guys were all like neighbors and stuff, right? Yeah.
Yeah. I was going to do a side project called Suicide Shift with Darren Travis and DiGiorgio. And John Allen was going to jump in, but he was just jamming with us at the time. And that's kind of why I was out that way and was moving out there. And then once we knew Greg left, I said, hey, Steve, you know, you want to join Testament, you know? And Steve's a monster bass player, you know?
Fuck,
and
yeah. Sick.
And once he got into the groove, he took it over the top, you know? And it was something that we needed to, coming into the band, a breath of fresh air. I mean, I'm sure you know this, you know, but just having new blood, new people to hang out, new just attitude, just everything. It just changed the band again and made the touring part of it fun again. And, you know, because we had some downer moments, you know, once we got out with Greg, you know. It was more like business and it wasn't being fun. It was just like guys that didn't talk to each other and just, you know, passed each other in the hall and did our job and moved on, and that's not fun, and that could get old really quick. So when Steve got back in, it got fun again, and his character, and it actually inspired Eric some more, and it really started working again. And then of course I get sick, and it all fell apart, and put it all in the back burner, you know. But Steve found his way back, you know, after Greg left again the second time. And again, he brought back what needed to get back into the band. Just new fresh air, his energy, just who he is. And I think with him back in the band and Gene back in the band and Alex, we're at a place where we're at the best place ever in the band because we all get along so well. We never argue. We never have disagreements. We've learned how to live with each other. And it's a good working thing. And I think that's important, you know, as you can tell it.
Totally. I mean, that's so much of life in a band is about living together. It's not about the playing, you know, it's the living.
Yeah. And when we go away from the road, we all don't communicate as much with each other, but we do when we get back out there. It's good to see you. Good, you know, and we work together and we make it happen and we get along and we make it work. And that's what's we're fortunate right now in the band the outside of world of that bus doesn't affect us as much as it used to in the past of what other people thought of what we're doing or what we're creating. So now it's just like, you know what? We're getting along and I'm joining it and you're joining it. We're having fun. And guess what? If they don't dig
That's so much more important. Yeah. It's so much more important than everything. Here,
dude,
yeah.
You know, but guess what? I'm digging it and we're having
stay
fun.
Stay home, motherfucker. Stay home. Because you got 50 other bands you can listen to. Like, yeah, I need to hear
but if you do come here, guess what? You're going to have something fun and enjoy it because we're into it and we're having the best time and we're good, you know? Yeah. So come down and get some good with us, you know?
Right. Totally. Fuck. Totally. Take me back to you get the diagnosis that you have this very kind of rare kind of cancer. I guess it's testicular cancer, but it's affecting your heart and
Everybody, when you're born, your germ cells are basically your testicles all the way up your spine through your spine. So basically everybody has testicles all up down their spine. Well, mine form was up in my chest towards that area, basically. And so
you're like Chuck Billy's got balls.
Balls in his chest. Yeah. You should see the balls on his heart. You know? Right. Yeah. Yeah. But you know, that was a strange time, you know, because I had been working with Willie Lang at Lang Trucking since 97. My wife Tiffany had been in a bad accident at the time and wasn't working. And of course, times have changed and I wasn't making much ends meet and decided I got to go get a job. Went and talked to Willie and he's fortunate to give me some work and, you know, started working then and, you know, forgot where I was going with this, but
yeah,
you know, it all started,
yeah,
you know,
start work, yeah, like you're starting to work, you're, you know, the band's not slowing down, but you're still like, you gotta
trying to make ends meet. And, and you know, we have the Gathering record, we're happy, things are going good. And then one day,
do you tour behind the Gathering? Do you start the tour cycle?
We started touring and we're touring behind it. And then one day off tour, a lady comes to my house because she's a real estate agent, actually knocks on my door and says, she has this doctor wants to buy my house. And I'm like, oh, I'm going to sell my house. But how much?
That's so random.
Yeah. Right. And she gave me a number and I said, well, you know what? If you're going to sell it for that much, I'll sell this house. So we moved and that's when we moved to Antioch. And that's because I was jammed with Steve. I chose Antioch because I was jamming with those guys and it was too far to come back to the Bay Area to get physicals and our dentist. So we decided, okay, we're going to get new dentists, new doctors. And I never go to the doctor and get a physical. I haven't did that since like high school. So we had to pick new doctors and John Allen's wife worked at the local hospital. And she said, you know, here's a doctor, go meet him. So of course we set up a physical to go get family checkups. And I go in there and he tells me that calls me back that night and says, hey, you know, I want you to come back and do a chest x-ray because I see a mass from the x-ray. I want you to do a CAT scan. And so I did. I went back in and that's when he said, you know, there's a mass and now we want to go in and do a biopsy on it. And that's when I'm like, wow, what's up? You know, and so they blood work didn't look well. And, you know, until
you
they
felt
went
fine.
In.
You felt fine.
Yeah. Felt fine.
Yeah.
You know, crazy. And it's funny because I was working at the yard and guys were smoking cigarettes down there. So I picked up, started smoking cigarettes down there. And then And now the next thing, I was like, man, I was having a hard time breathing. You know, I was like, man, these cigarettes killing me. I can't breathe. I better stop smoking these cigarettes. And instead, what happened, I had a tumor the size of a squash in my chest cavity. So every time I breathed, it was just filled up and I couldn't breathe. But my body had built up an immune system, built up a wall around it, and basically was protecting it. So when they did my first biopsy, the results came back negative of anything. It didn't go deep enough. The second one, they went in for my sign and pierced it too deep to where it actually ruptured it and started spilling. And they're like, okay, oh, you got to start chemo Monday right away.
Holy
and
I went
straight
shit.
Into chemo, you know.
That's fucking crazy.
Yeah. But it was just a weird deal because when I went back in to the doctor, you know, to get my results, Tiffany didn't go with me. And he tells me I have cancer and kind of went in one ear out the other, really. And I got home and it really didn't hit me until Tiffany asked me, you know, what the doctor said. And I said, well, he said I had cancer. And when I said it, I just went, whoa, and it just kind of overwhelmed me. And it just kind of, that's when it hit me. I sat on the couch and pretty much cried like a baby for that day and felt down and bad, you know, and just thought the worst because cancer is like a scary word. And
fuck yeah.
I didn't know what stage or what, I just knew I had it. And so,
and they told, but at this point, you know that you've got a mass the size of a squash.
I know I have a mass and I know it's cancerous. Fucking, then after they had the biopsy and I felt that bad that first day, but the next day I literally put on my big boy pants, pulled them up and said, bullshit, you know, we're fighting this. And went into a different frame of mind. I knew I was going to have to do all the chemo, but I went back to my native roots and really started, you know, reaching out to some healers and some medicine men. And I have a friend down in south of in Los Angeles named Nancy, who has been a longtime friend. And one day I had a show down there and we all went to the Rainbow after the show. And she says,
hey, Chuck, you're still doing shows even with the cancer?
No, this is before I knew. I'm just telling you a pre-story
before
this.
Oh, gotcha.
Before I knew I had the cancer, we did a show on the Gathering Tour, and we were at the Rainbow. And she said, hey, Chuck, you know, I had this dream of you, because she kept trying to introduce me to Charlie, this healer. She's like, you got to meet him. You got to meet him. He reminds me of your younger brother. You got to meet him. And I hadn't met him for years. And finally, at that Rainbow meeting, she says, you got to meet Charlie. You know, I had this dream last night that you and Charlie were sitting around a fire putting on war paint together about to go into this battle. And I'm like, yeah, whatever, Nancy. And, you know, right. And so when I was sick, when I was at home one day, that Charlie guy appears up at my house and knocks on my door. And right away says, hey, I'm Charlie. And right away I knew who he was. And I, you know, he was really familiar, looked like my brother. And I knew. And he says, I'm here to do a healing on you. And he took me inside and laid me on the ground and did a healing ceremony on me and had a flute and he was chanting and singing. And
that's awesome.
And had his flute and I had my eyes closed and I felt like I was flying and floating through the air and I can hear the wolves howling and the flute and everything. And it was blowing me away. And when I was done with it, he sat me down and says, okay, I'm going to tell you a few things, and they're probably not going to make sense right now, but things are going to happen. They'll start falling into place and they'll kind of make sense to you. But the wind is going to be your spirit guide through this. And I said, okay, whatever. I don't know what to make of all this. And he left and he was gone. So we have a party going on and I'm doing my chemo and all this stuff. And I go to have a party and I was having stomach issues. Like I just couldn't go to the bathroom, maybe from the chemo. And I was just congested and, you know, and one day I went downstairs and we had a party and I went downstairs and it just happened to be really windy that night. And the furniture got blown in the pool and it woke me up and I started having stomach. So I went downstairs to a guest bathroom and sat on the toilet, released something out of my body. And when I was sitting on the toilet outside the bathroom window was like a little funnel cloud of beer cans that were just clink, 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 clinking around in the wind. And after I released that out of my body into the toilet, I had this overwhelming sensation that I just got rid of the sickness. And as that happened, the wind stopped and the cans hit the ground and got quiet. And I went upstairs and woke up Tiffany, right? Said, Tiff, I just basically shit the cancer out the toilet last downstairs. She's like, what the fuck are you talking about? I'm like, yeah, I don't know how to explain it, but I just got rid of my cancer. And whatever, she's just asleep. Yeah. And so that week I go to my doctor and I take my blood work and I go in and he comes back and he says, hey, I don't know what's up, but your tumor's cancer free. And wow. I look at Tiffany and I go, see, I told you. I'm believing, but the whole process of my healing and the thing was the power of believing that this shit's really working. This shit's happening. Yes. And I'm doing this, you know, and I had these other two experiences with medicine men that were just mind blowing. That
you did some sweat lodges, right?
I did a sweat lodge down in LA, and the same person, Nancy, I went down to visit her with my friend Tommy. And it was when they're having the big floods down there that weekend. And we were going to the Santa Barbara Mountains for the sweat lodge, and the streets of LA were flooded. And she's like, well, I guess we can't go tomorrow. It's too flooded. And I'm like, bullshit, we're going. And we were going up the Grapevine back up from LA. It's like at the top there, you got to hang a left going towards the Santa Barbara Mountains, towards the ocean. Mm-hmm. And as we were climbing that Grapevine and got to our exit, it started, the sky broke open, sunlight, and it was raining like a motherfucker in LA. The sky broke out. We got off the freeway, we're heading west towards the ocean. It starts hailing, then it starts snowing. The sky breaks,
crazy.
And we're going through all these elements.
What the fuck?
That's exactly what we're saying. We're like, what the fuck is going on? And we're going through all these elements, and when we finally arrive on the road, we got to go off-road about 10 miles to get to the lodge. And I just bought a Suburban at this time. We had packed down and four-wheel. I'd never used it in four-wheel. I'm like, oh, yeah, we're going to do some four-wheeling here. And we got to the lodge, and I went and did a sweat, and we found ourselves up on the hill of this mountain. And we're standing in our boxer shorts with a towel around us, and it's snowing. And they got the fire pit going with all the rocks that are connected to the sacred fire pit that goes to the sweat lodge. It's got to always be connected to the fire. And we're standing around. I'm with my son, and he's 14 at the time, and he's in his underwear. Okay, I'm going, are you cold? And he's like, no. And I'm like, I'm not either. And we're not by the fire. And I'm like, this is trippy. It's snowing, and I'm not even cold, you know? And it was just this weird aura of the place and where we were at and what we were doing. And we got in there, did the sweat lodge, and they love Cody being in there because kids give a lot of energy in the sweat lodge. And I went in there, and he did a healing ceremony on me out in the fire pit. And we left from there and went up to the Sierras. And I met another medicine man named Lupon, and he's a direct descendant of Geronimo.
Wow.
And Eric Peterson, he went up there with me, and I had some friends from Holland here. And my friend Tommy knows it was one of his buddy's best friends. Well, he lives with wild wolves and raises wild wolves. So in order to go to his house, you have to go to the house, approach the porch. If the head wolf shows aggression towards you, you got to turn around and get back in the van and split.
So, oh, wow.
So my buddy Tommy's Holy uncle shit. Takes
oh,
me
so
up
he's
there.
He's got like wild wolves wild greeting wolves. You at the uh-huh. fucking, oh my
yeah, at his
God.
House. So I go up there, Eric and his son and my son, and they're all sitting in the van and they're like, I'm staying here. Said, all right, I'm going. I'm here. I'm going. So I start going, walking through, and I walked through. He didn't show aggression. Got through, and it was a big wolf, scary looking thing. And so I asked can I bring my son with me? Because I want him with me. So we bring my son. It's just me and him. We go inside, and he sits me down, and he tells me some stories. And he says, I'm going to teach you a healing technique that you could use, because he had told him how my tumor is too big to operate to get it out. So I'm going to teach you some technique.
Oh, was that what they were saying? That it was too big to operate to take it out?
On
oh,
them. Yeah.
Wow.
So I was trying to figure out, take chemo or something to get the tumor to shrink. So I went to him, and he was going to show me techniques to shrink the tumor. So he had taught me how to ground myself with the earth, reaching my arms, picturing myself reaching so down in the earth with my arms, grounding myself to the earth. And he says, now wherever your problem is, focus on that tumor and that squash in your chest right now. Now focus and put a circle around that tumor. Now that tumor represent that focus represents something strong. Pick a color that represents strength to you. Now focus that energy and put that circle around that tumor. And something about grounding that he, as he taught me to do that and believe in doing that, that's what shrunk the tumor. Well, I wasn't fully convinced, but I'm still in the mindset that I believe in whatever I'm doing with my native people. I believe this is going to work. And so I did it. I went home and did the process. And God damn it, like 2.5 weeks later, the tumor was the size of an orange, enough to operate on.
Crazy.
And so, crazy, right? And you
that's
know,
that's fucking amazing.
All these wild things are happening to me through my experience, through my native experience. And it's blowing me away. And I go, I don't know what it is, but it's the power of the mind believing that the shit is working and it's happening and my mind's healing. And I do know when I was doing the chemo the whole time, I really approached that as, I never really got sick or threw up. I lost my hair and all that, but I always.
You lost all your hair?
Yeah, my eyebrows, everything.
Wow.
And I was on like a steroid. So I put on like 30, 40 pounds. I wasn't me, you know?
Yeah.
But I approached it mentally as I was just taking cough syrup for my flu. You know, I wasn't thinking this is chemo, deadly, nasty shit, you know, radiation that I'm ingesting in my body. Right. So I didn't let it affect me. And I kind of, you know, that's how it got me through it. A lot of my native stuff and focusing on what I did and what they taught me and learned. And that really helped, you know. And so then when I went to have my operation, when I first went in, they realized I had a damaged heart valve. And then when I was going to go in there, they had a pig valve, basically, that they were going to replace my valve while I had me open. And when I went in there, I was opened up for like 9 hours. And they decided at that point that you're going to have to go. We're going to have to close you up. You've been open too long. And we're going to have to come back and do a second operation and repair the valve.
Oh, geez.
So I come out of the operation in a hell of pain and find out that I have to go back in for another one, that they couldn't do it.
Yeah, they're going through your sternum.
They
right?
cracked me open, clamshelled me.
Yeah. I mean, that's fucking brutal.
Oh yeah. And so I was in some pretty good pain getting out of there. But once I learned how to have another operation after going through the pain, I was like, oh my God, I can't go through that. No way. And so I'm waiting to have my second operation, and then the doctor comes back and goes, I don't know what happened, but your valve started working, and now we don't have to have your second operation. It healed itself. Crazy. With its operation, and it's working fine. And I'm like, how? You said it was damaged, you know? And they're like, we have no explanation. So I don't
what
know.
What color did you imagine around your heart?
It's crystal blue. And I just wrote a song on their new record about it, you know, about Rad. My healer and the story about meeting all my healers and what they did, you know.
And that is such a fucking rad story.
Crystal blue,
dude.
is my color for healing. And it's just, you know, Mike grew up as my mom being real religious and Catholic, and I went to catechism and Catholic school through like almost 9th, 10th grade. But, you know, I have a whole different aspect on myself and what my stance is on being religious. I wouldn't say I call myself religious anymore. I call myself spiritual now. You know, I have a spirituality and belief. That a lot of people have spirituality and can believe in higher powers and believe in strength in any culture, as long as it's mm-hmm. believing in something.
Yeah. Yeah. So, there's hundreds of higher powers for,
right.
And
so
hundreds
I find,
of cultures.
I want to be spiritual, not religious. That's you know, my choice to be now.
That is a fucking awesome story. Like
it's crazy, right?
That's so fucking crazy, dude. Like the fucking wolf and the fucking sticking your hands in a mat. You know, like I was like listening to you and like all the stuff that he's telling you. And like, it really was like, you know, imagine you reaching, you know, grounding to the earth. That's so fucking, dude,
yeah, and
that's
and
awesome.
I did it and I was believing it. And, you know, and I attribute part of it or believe a part of it. Cause you always hear, you know, ancient Chinese medicine, they can slow down their heart rate and do all this stuff right. and control their body with their mind. Well, I kind of took that in to believe that, you know, that maybe there's something to that, you know?
Yeah.
The way I approached it.
Yeah. And I'm sure with the combination of, you know, the chemo and that together, you know, like some people, so much of it is about that. I mean, it sounds like a pretty serious thing you had to go through anyway. It's fucking gigantic mass in your body.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you just don't know the outcomes, what's going to happen. But as I was living it, I was kind of just, you know, like I said, the spirituality of just like, wow. And just taking, they always say, how do you, I'm always asked that question. How do you live life now after an experience like that? And it's like, it's hard to explain because unless you're there, you know, I'm sure I'm more lax now than I was when I first started, you know, realizing that I'm coming through and I beat this and I'm, you know, I just, you know, don't want it to come back and I want to live my life and what can I do to be better or live happier or whatever, you know, for the time I have now, you know?
Right. But in so many ways, it's like you had this bad situation and yet you were able to find, you know, many silver linings in it. You know, you probably got closer with Tiff and it sounds like you got closer with Tiff and your son, you know, you find this connection to the earth, you find this spirituality, like there's like, yeah, it was a bad thing, but so many good things, you know, a multitude of good things came out.
The good and bad things with the business and the industry to still going, oh, you know what? Now I really kind of enjoy being in the industry and what I do with my band now, you know, it's like,
right.
You know, there isn't any pressure anymore. You know, right. I think you get to that spot in a career, music career or any career, once you get over and accomplish that hump, and now it's a matter of just maintaining and sustaining what you do. And, you know, and I think we've been lucky to be able to do that, all of us, you know, and that have careers in this type of music, you know, that doesn't get the accolades or the respect or, you know, what a lot of other music out there does, you know, that we are fighting for ourselves and
absolutely
getting what we get, you know?
I mean, another good thing that came out of if there was good things that came out of this, the first Thrash of the Titans was the, Thrash of the Titans.
Yeah.
Reunion. All of the bands getting together to raise money for you and, you know, to help you and through Chuck. This and Chuck crazy time.
Yeah, Chuck Schuldiner. Yeah,
oh, was it Chuck from Death too? Okay, gotcha.
Yeah,
okay.
We split the profits for that show once we found out he was ill and we decided that we were going to share and split the profits.
Oh, right on. Yeah, I didn't know that.
Yeah, that was really special. And I think Walter Morgan, you know, really took that upon himself. You know, when he first approached me and says, hey, if you ever want a show, who would you want? And, you know, when you ask that question, of course, you know, for me, you know, oh, well, Anthrax and, you know, of course I can't get Metallica. I know, I'm not even going to ask, but I started naming all the bands that, you know, I would love to see again and knowing Exodus and, you know, Violence and Death Angel and all these bands that don't play anymore. I would love to see that. You know?
Everybody's on hiatus at this point.
I would love to see that again. And the beauty of it was that a lot of those bands put whatever differences they had aside and just came together and had, I guess, one of the most amazing reunions for all bands, because every band that haven't seen or performed together were awesome. Like awesome. I mean, just like, wow. And people from around the world came to see that. And that just really, really made a statement to who the Bay Area is and what we've done to the world and how they supported us, giving it back, you know, and that was pretty awesome, you know, to see that. And for all the other bands to really keep moving forward and hit those differences aside and just say, you know what, let's just do it. And even Testament, we got to get back together because of that, that show, you know, right. For us, that we wouldn't, we would have never happened if I didn't get sick. I really believe that. If that show didn't happen, Testament wouldn't have happened. Maybe not even the Exodus and the rest of them. Who knows? They wouldn't have had that opportunity to do that. So in a sense, I had to go to hell to get to where we are today. You know, I mean, we all had to be there and experience and get there and come out on the other side. Now, all of us, like, we're living life. We're all making a living. It's something we all love to do. Unfortunately, it's changing and out of our control. And
now,
and, you know, trying to figure out what we do going forward, you know?
Yeah. I mean, you've had a hell of a run since you came back. I mean, I mean, Formation of Damnation was, I mean, that fucking whoa is just one of the best songs you guys ever wrote, in my opinion.
Oh, thank you.
I mean, and to have a fucking a fantastic song like that, you know, far into a band's career isn't always, you know, isn't always the case. And like fucking that whole record, and, you know, even like I was listening to like the Brotherhood of the Snake meeting, and I was just like, I had no idea it was about this whole like ancient alien fucking, you know, like you, I heard that, like, what the fuck? Like, this is some crazy shit, man. I like it.
Yeah, I mean, you're always trying to stay on top of writing something different or what inspires you. And, you know, I had a few years inspired by ancient aliens, especially after my thing of spirituality. I'm open to there's something else out there in this universe. Right. You know, I believe in the afterlife. I'm open to a lot of this, that we're not the only thing here in existence. I'm open to all this, you know?
Right. Yeah. I mean, I think they just, and then the Pentagon just announced something about like that UFOs are like, they've been like, you know, and 2020 has been so crazy. It was just like a blip on the radar. Like, people were just like, what? No, fuck.
Yeah, I know. Right. And that would be an interesting to see if they ever do release and come and share what, you know, what we all think so they're hiding, you know, or there's got to be something out there. I mean, there's too much things, and people have reported too much sightings of stuff that, you know, that don't make sense, that there's no way on this. I'm so into the watching those programs. I'm just like, well, he's seen it in that county and way over here and then way over here. Yeah. And they're all reporting the same exact thing at the same exact time. And they don't even know each other.
Or come even on, in the ancient times when all of the fucking aliens, like, they've all got the long arms, they've all got like the big eyes, they've all, you know, like, and these are different, like, this is in China and in Peru and in, you know,
they're all over the walls and documented, like, everywhere. They always call them as star people, you know, they're all the star people in all the cultures. And it's like, there has to be a connection. There's no way. And so that to me, that whole alien thing really pushed me over the top to going, you know what, I'm going to say I'm not religious. I'm spiritual. And I believe in a little more.
Right.
Openness to the wackiness.
I like that a lot. That's a good note to wrap this up on, man.
Right on. Yeah.
I gotta say, I'm super glad that you battled through all that stuff, man. Like, I'm glad you're here, and I'm super, thanks for sharing that crazy the Sweat Lodge story. That was fucking, I'm like, I'm on a high right now. Like, that was a fucking rad story, dude. Like, it was awesome. You know,
right on.
I mean, you've been a big supporter of Machine Head. I remember going to your house. I want to say we had just finished our demo that we had did with Joey, where I had my amp in the bathroom and like all this shit. And I remember playing it for you at your San Leandro house. And I remember you were like, fuck, this is fucking awesome. And I was like, I was so juiced that you were into it. Like, it made me all fucking like, I can fucking do this. Like, I can do this. You know what I mean? So, you know, even from the inspiration you've given me all throughout these years, you know, you took Violence on our first tour ever, dude. Like, so, you know, thank you for everything you've done to help, you know, my bands out. And, you know, it's awesome. Well,
thanks
that
for
you're
having
so
me, Rob. And, you know, you've been, we represent the Bay, and we, I know myself and you, we'll stick together for anything Bay Air supporting. And we've done some benefits and supported our friends in the Bay Area.
Fuck yeah.
I'm sure there'll be many more. And speaking of that, I threw this out to Gary Holt, and I said, you know what? When I watched Murder in the Front Row, I watched and I go, you know what, that scene, Gary, when they show Paul's grave, Paul is an iconic figure in the Bay Area as far as what he represents. Let's find out if we can do something to get Paul a better stone and do a nice show and all of us get together. And he deserves that, you know, because I think he's for me, I know he is a Bay Area milestone for metal, what it's done for the world. And when I go to the foreign countries and see Phil and Ott and I see Bon Scott statues, God damn it, they need to see Paul Bailoff.
They need Paul Bailoff.
Right? I mean, I truly believe it.
I mean, we were just on the tour and the joke of the whole Burn My Eyes 25th anniversary tour was, what would Bailoff do? Like when it came to a time no, he would hate this. Like, fuck, this is it. No, he was
that's a common phrase. What would Bailoff do? Kill poses. Man. That's what
yeah, kill poses. Kill poses like a motherfucker. Fuck yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know if I caught that. I guess is his headstone like kind of, you know.
Yeah, it's very unmarked. Meager. You know. Yeah. Okay. Very. And I was like, Gary, man, let's find out from the cemetery if we couldn't do that, put something there. And if so, let's do that. You know.
I mean, I'd be down to chip. I don't know if we can do a show, but I'd be down to chip in some money, you know, for sure.
Yeah, just do a show and raise some money.
Whenever shows resume.
I mean, we could probably do it without even doing it and do something Zoom and do it on the line. But it's a good cause, I think, and something that we well deserve and Paul deserves that.
Absolutely. That's a great idea, dude. That's awesome. I'm 100% in. Fucking Exodus has, you know, been one of the, you know, biggest influences of my musical career. So, absolutely.
Well, cool. Well, right on for having me, Robb. I hope and your family are doing well during all this craziness. You know.
Yeah, give my best to Tiff. Joey said hello.
I will.
Yeah.
Right on, man.
Take it easy, man. Late.
See you later.
Ladies and gentlemen, that was the one, the only Chuck Billy from Testament. Yeah.